The rain is gone. The sun is shining. It's a beautiful day. And the rain-delayed Haynes 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race is about to begin.
Martinsville Speedway, side of the sixth and final slugfest, I mean short track race of the season. Today, 42 cars will push and shove their way 500 times around this paperclip-shaped half-mile oval. You know, for 50 years, drivers have been searching for the secret to success here. They know this close-quarters racing can make or break your season or points championship hopes. You know, last time we were on a track this size, it had huge implications for the points contenders. You say you want proof? Well, let's turn back the clock to 1 month ago.
The chance to take the lead.
And Dale Jarrett goes back in the lead.
Oh, Jeff Gordon slides up the hill and loses the lead. Oh, and he wins. This is what a short track can do to a points lead.
That's exactly the kind of finish Dale Jarrett and Mark Martin need today, while hoping Jeff Gordon has problems similar to his Bristol nightmare. But this is Martinsville. It's tight and it's tough. It's part pavement, part concrete, and all wall. So here's what you're looking at today. The fact that one of NASCAR's tiniest tracks could have one of the biggest influences on the chase for the 1997 Winston Cup Championship. You have to be good to win here. You have to be lucky to survive. Martinsville is a microscopic look at racing. You're constantly surrounded by speed. Behind you, beside you, beating you. A tiny stage packed with the game's biggest names. But here it's not the stars, it's the props. You want Hot Wheels? This is the place. Your brakes can go up in flames. Looks are deceiving. Sheet metal crinkles like tissue paper. Gears hot as fire get fragile as glass. You have to watch where you're going, even if you're not sure where that is. Martinsville makes you want to scream.
It has been a weekend of mixed blessings for points contender Dale Jarrett. On Friday, he qualified good enough to start on the front stretch in 21st spot. But on Saturday, his Thunderbird became a rolling inferno when an alternator belt came off and ripped the fuel line completely out of the carburetor. Suddenly, raw fuel all over the engine beneath the car. It erupts in flames. Maybe that was a mixed blessing. That car was not handling very well. This backup car handles much better. The only bad side is now DJ has to start 42nd shotgun on the field. As we are set for the command here at Martinsville Speedway, 71,000 people have come back to hear these words.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
Of the Haynes 500 here on the 50th anniversary of NASCAR's shortest racetrack, Martinsville Speedway. Let's go upstairs to our expert analyst, a couple of former Winston Cup champions who will help with the call today. Here's Benny Parsons and Ned Jarrett.
Bill Weber talked about it on his opening. Talked about the brakes and the gear. Folks, this racetrack is as hard as any racetrack on the circuit mechanically. The brakes, the gear, and the engines. They turn the engines so many RPMs trying to help the brakes that they turn up too many RPMs. Mechanical failure is always a problem at Martinsville.
Boy, every part on the car gets a workout here. And this racetrack can be devastating to the championship contenders. You know, on the big racetracks, sometimes they can find them a place to run if they get up in the top 5 or 10 and sit there and ride for a few hundred miles till near the end of the race with no cars behind them or beside them or in front of them. Doesn't work that way here at the Martinsville Speedway. Things, the unexpected, can happen almost at any time. A few years ago, Jeff Gordon was leading the race, coming off of turn four. Sterling Marlin in the car number four spun behind him. All the other cars get by, but watch what happens as Gordon comes around trying to keep Dale Earnhardt a lap down. Marlin gets his car to moving up into Gordon. He goes into the wall. His day is done as far as winning the race. You never know what's going to happen here at Martinsville.
ESPN, the world leader in motorsports coverage, welcomes you live to Martinsville Speedway in Virginia for coverage of the NASCAR Winston Cup Haynes 500. It's the 27th race of the season. Jeff Gordon has been in the points lead for the last four races. Couple of close battles behind him, though. Sixth place Dale Earnhardt just 11 behind Terry Labonte. And Ricky Rudd is just about 25 points behind Ted Musgrave. Hi, everyone. I'm Bob Jenkins. And although we're a day late, we certainly celebrate the 50th year of racing here at Martinsville Speedway. It was on September 7th, 1947, that this place opened its doors before 6,013 screaming fans. Well, a lot of change since then. The capacity here is 71,000. The drivers will be going for $1.2 million this afternoon. And, of course, there's also those very precious Winston Cup points that are available to all of the drivers. Let's check the starting lineup for today's race. On the pole, Ward Burton from South Boston, Virginia, his third career pole, alongside Mark Martin, last week's pole winner and race winner. Starting in the second row, Kenny Irwin Jr., his second Winston Cup start. Both have been in the top three. And Hutz Strickland, his best start of 97. Ricky Rudd, with two Martinsville wins, goes fifth. And Kenny Wallace, sixth. He was April's pole winner here at Martinsville. Seventh place starter is Rusty Wallace. Five of his six Martinville wins have been in the last nine races. And Joe Nemechek, whose first front row start of the season was here in April. Starting ninth will be Ken Schrader, a two-time pole winner in 97. And Jeff Burton, who has top fives in the last two short track races. Starting 11th will be Jeff Gordon, the winner of the last two Martinsville races, and Jimmy Spencer, his best Martinsville finish, third in the 93 race. Dale Earnhardt goes 13th, six Martinsville wins, three in this event, and on the outside of him will be Sterling Marlin.
On the inside of row eight is John Andretti, fifth year in 96 in this race, and Bill Elliott on the outside, he's finished third year twice. On the inside of row nine is Robert Presley. On the outside, Darrell Waltrip, 11 victories here at Martinsville. In row 10, on the inside is Mike Skinner. On the outside, Bobby Labonte. In row 11, Dale Jarrett, two victories on the short tracks this year, five victories altogether. On the outside, Bobby Hamilton, second here in the spring. In row 12, Ted Musgrave, the 94 pole winner here, and Lake Speed. Back in row 13 on the inside is Cherry Labonte, fourth year in the spring. On the outside, Johnny Benson. On the inside is Michael Waltrip, a father last night, a baby girl to he and Buffy. Congratulations. And his second Winston Cup start on the outside is Steve Park.
Making up row 15 are Kyle Petty and Ernie Irvin. Don't look for them to stay back there too long. Both have strong cars here in practice on Saturday. Dick Trickle and David Green make up row 16. Trickle has two third-place finishes here. And then Jeff Green, David's brother, will start with Chad Little in row 17. Both the Greens making their first start in Winston Cup competition here at Martinsville. Row 18, we find Wally Dallenbach Jr. and Ricky Craven. Row 19, Jeff Bodine, who has several wins here in NASCAR Winston Cup competition, and Rick Mast, who lives in the state of Virginia. This is his home track. And row 20, Jeremy Mayfield and Steve Grissom, they got into the race on provisionals, and Brett Bodine and Derek Cope also got in on provisionals.
Just three drivers failed to qualify for the field. Gary Bradbury, Morgan Shepherd back in the number one car, and Dave Marcus also failing to miss the field. Several onboard cameras for you to enhance our coverage here today. This is Ricky Craven, who will be starting back in 36th position.
Also, Bobby Labonte, the Food Line onboard camera. He will start 20th. And Jeff Burton, the Exide Ford, will start 10th. We're right along with Jeff.
Rusty Wallace also has an onboard camera, starting in 7th position. The number 8 car of Hutch Strickland has a camera mounted above his right, and he will be starting in fourth position. And finally, Mark Martin, who is on the outside of row number one. In the last six races of the season, the points earned on the average, now this is the last six races of the year, 94, 95, and 96, Mark Martin has outscored Jeff Gordon. And if you do some subtraction here, you will find the difference, 105, and that is exactly the point lead that Jeff Gordon has on Mark Martin as we enter this event. Well, we'll go 500 laps here today. The track record is 82.2 miles an hour by Jeff Gordon. They'll need fuel between laps 160 and 180, and the purse over $1.2 million. Taking a look at the manufacturer's battle, Ford has a lead over Chevrolet in both points and number of wins. And Pontiac, of course, has seven representatives in the field today, 21 Fords and 14 Chevrolets.
They're running some extra laps here today because these cars went through inspection yesterday, were parked, and the crews were not able to touch those cars this morning. So they've started them up, they let them warm up a little bit, they're running a couple extra laps to make sure that the lubricants in the car are starting to warm up and get a little bit thinner because the fluid in the gear, for instance, is 90 weight oil in these gears. Jerry Funk?
And Benny, all they let them do this morning was jack them up and run the rear end for a few minutes. That was before they rolled them over there in place. They did not have the rear end warmers over there. They let them change the air cleaners and the spark plugs. Otherwise, the crews could not touch the cars. And that, as you said, is the reason NASCAR gave them an extra lap to warm up the gears, which are so critical here at Martinsville. Green, next time by.
Indeed, less than a half lap till we begin this event.
You know, we're always talking about rubbers in the spring. That right there is the rubber that we're always talking about. If they need to change the chassis, they can jerk that out and change the chassis.
All right, we're set to go here. A day late with just as much excitement and enthusiasm from the fans gathered. The green flag is out. The Haynes 500 is on.
Wants that lead because he's trying to get on the outside.
And Ward Burton has just led his first competitive lap at Martinsville, and it becomes the third event in 1997 that Ward has led.
And here's Mark trying to look on the inside. He wants a 5 bonus point for leading the lap badly.
There's Jeff Gordon. Jimmy Spencer and Dale Earnhardt, and beside him is Sterling Marlin.
That row inside is so filled up that those cars are having to stay on the outside, and sometimes that outside lane is the fastest in the first few laps because everybody trying to get to the inside and they can't run as fast as they would be capable of.
And here goes Mark on the inside trying to take the lead, comes off the corner, loses the back just a little bit. And Warren Burton holds him off, but here comes Mark again.
Pulls to the inside of him, and at the line, Ward still has about a half a car length advantage. Let's see if the lead swaps down in turns one and two. Mark with a little bit better run, it looks like. They're wheel to wheel, side by side down the back stretch.
And that inside groove should be the preferred one. He should be able to get the lead coming off of turn four.
But Ward Burton gets a run, and I think Ward had it again, but this time he decides to back off and let Mark Martin go.
A little bit loose there around the corner, so it was 5 laps that Ward Burton led. Now Mark Martin has control of the race as we watch Ricky Rudd racing there with Joe Nemechek, Rusty Wallace, and Jeff Burton.
And Nemechek making the outside group work for him pretty well.
This is for the sixth position we're watching the battle for from Rusty's perspective. And now on board with Jeff Burton. Camera mounted in the right front of the car. This is our Kmart onboard camera that Jeff is carrying this morning and this afternoon.
Looking from the back of Rusty Wallace's car as he camera sees Jeff Burton right on his bumper. And this is what's going on right behind those guys as Ricky Rudd and Joe Nemechek continue to battle it out, and Nemechek is going to get the position.
And Russ is going to try to dive to the inside of Ricky Rudd. Can't quite make it. Yes, he can.
Rudd gives him the room he needs. Just a car whip, that's all he wanted.
Ricky Rudd says, you know, Nemechek made that outside group work. Let me try it out here and see how it runs. But it's just okay. It's not as good as that inside group. It's just okay.
And the inside groove is not as good for those who are battling as it would be if they're out running by themselves where they can make the full arch into the turn.
Awesome. Side-by-side battling going on back here. Dale Jarrett, remember, he had to go to the tail of the field to start the race because he's running a backup car after a fire on Saturday during practice. There he is. He's gained a couple of positions.
Yeah, he's having to be very careful back there because a lot of racing going on among that group back there as well.
Jeremy Mayfield is just ahead of him, as is Derek Cope and Jeff Bodine. Running back in 40th position at the moment. Just Brett Bodine and Wally Dahlenbach trailing. Here is Mayfield to the inside of Jeff Bodine. Bodine hung up on the outside there, and it didn't work for him.
I said at the, when we introduced the drivers that Ernie Irvin might not stay back there. He started in 30th position. He is moving towards the front, guys. He just now picked off the 21st position. Make that the 21st position, and is moving towards the front.
He had a very good car in happy hour Saturday that we televised for you, and obviously the car is running well here this morning.
The 40 car is Steve Park. We introduced him and said this is his second NASCAR West Cup start. 7-4 Robbie Gordon, who ran the California 500 or the kart race yesterday in California Speedway.
Had a top 10 finish too yesterday, didn't he? Good run for Robbie.
8th or 9th.
Yeah. Right there. Yeah. Oh, a little contact there between Irvin and the 18 of Bobby Labonte. There you see that Irvin started in 30th position but picked up 3 spots on the first lap. Now at lap number 13, he is in 20th position. Mark Martin is the leader of the race coming into this event. This is the only track that Ford had not led on in 1997. But with Mark Martin out in front, they now add this track to the list. We'll be right back. ESPN Speed World coverage from Martinsville Speedway in Virginia, the Haynes 500 on this Monday morning. It's all being brought to you by Quaker State, the quality your car deserves. By the more than 1,725 AutoZone stores across America, AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. And by Miller Genuine Draft, to remind you it's time for a good old macro brew. 23 laps completed here at Martinsville. The lead remains in the hands of Mark Martin, with Ward Burton second and Kenny Irwin Jr. running in third spot. Here is Darrell Waltrip, and he is off the pace. Bill Weber can tell us.
Well, Bob, Darrell was hoping for a good Monday here at Martinsville, where he has had so much success, but not now. He's off the lead lap and off the pace. The crew is not exactly sure what the problem is, but they're pointing an accusing finger at a possible spark plug wire that has come off. So they're hoping to get a caution and an opportunity to fix that. Here's Dr. Gary Bond.
Meanwhile, Kenny Traynor also having a problem, Bill. He started back in 9th position and is now back in 13th as he goes around Darrell Waltrip in the car number 17. Traynor, apparently the car very, very tight. They cannot get the car to turn right there coming off the corner out of turn 4. The car will not turn, primarily due to the fact that the track is green today with the rain having washed the rubber off.
There in 14th spot.
Let's see. Jeff Gordon started in 11th spot. It worked his way back to 14th, but now he's starting back to the front. He just passed Jimmy Spencer, so points leader Jeff Gordon back in 11th spot.
He was certainly one of the faster ones in practice, especially in long runs here on Saturday afternoon. A lot of people thought he would be, and he usually is, a man to beat when he comes to Martinsville.
So those three cars, Gordon, Spencer, Earnhardt, running exactly where they qualified, 11th, 12th, and 13th.
Jeff is going for his third consecutive victory here at Martinsville. He won in the spring, and he won this race last fall. There's Jimmy Spencer running in 12th spot, and Dale Earnhardt right behind him. And Sterling Marlin in 10th spot.
He's moved up four positions.
Running ninth.
He started fifth, so he's dropped four positions.
And Jeff Burton started 10th. Car direct in front of Ricky Rudd. He's up to eighth spot. As he tries to close in on the back of Rusty Wallace. Rusty started seventh, is currently running seventh. Meanwhile, back we're going to see our pylon change in just a second, as the 24 car is struggling with that four car trying to get by.
And he did get by.
So put Jeff Gordon up in the top 10.
This is the X side Ford, and there we see the Miller Lite Ford of Rusty Wallace as he looks back at Jeff Burton.
The field summary will show you where everybody's running, and the numbers in parentheses indicate their starting position.
Bill Nemechek, you know, that team has really turned it around. He told me at Richmond, you know, they qualified at Richmond, we had a discussion. He said, we really need to start finishing some races. We're running well, but we need to put the end to it, the period. And at Richmond, he did finish, I think, sixth that night, and he started to finish races. And that's what you got to do in this league. Winston Cup racing, you got to be there at the end. You got to put a period on the sentence.
And you recall, Joe was one of only three drivers who led here in the spring. He led 21 laps, starting on the outside of the front row. Kenny Wallace there in the 81, who has had good performances here at Martinsville in terms of starting position. Up ahead of him, Hutt Strickland and Kenny Irwin Jr. in the 27 car.
Boy, has that kid been impressive or what?
Well, he started outside the front row in Richmond and hung in there and finished in the top 10. And he started third here today and continues to run in that spot.
Strickland, there's been a big turnaround since Billy Engel moved over to the crew chief on the Circuit City Ford, which will be Chevrolet's next year.
Kenny Irwin will take over the 28 car, currently driven by Ernie Irvin. Well, here's some side-by-side racing.
And look who's the fastest car that time, Jeff Gordon. Oops. Whoa, we go back in the field to Steve Park.
Wow.
And Ernie Irvin that Ned talked about earlier.
Gordon ended up third quick in that lap, as we have a couple of guys who are running back in the 18th and 19th positions, setting fast laps at this time. Earnhardt having a bit of a problem getting around Marlin, but I think he's going to do it.
And up ahead, Jeff Gordon just went around Ricky Rudd. Over the ninth position. And Mark Martin just slowed here on the front straightaway, let Ford Burton go in front of him. Mark maybe was running a little bit harder than he wanted to, maybe having to use his brakes a little too much. I don't know, but he slowed down and let Ward Burton pass him going into turn one. He got the 5 bonus points, one thing that he wanted to get early. 5 bonus points in NASCAR Winston Cup racing if you lead at least a lap. Of course, there are 5 bonus points that goes to the driver who leads the most laps, but maybe Mark not thinking about that right now. Jerry Punch, you got more on Mark?
Well, you know, Ned, they were watching the same thing you and I were watching when he suddenly slowed and let Ward go back by him. The crew did not say anything to Mark Martin. He didn't say anything to them, but you know, Mark Martin's a very, very smart driver. He probably realized himself he was running a little too hard this early in the race on those brakes and on the gear. So without any prompting whatsoever, he backed out and let Ward go back by to run his own comfortable pace.
Jerry Punch was talking about the brakes, and we can show you what kind of beating they take. Look at how the rotor turns cherry red when the car goes down in the corner.
And this is very early in the race. Only a 40 couple laps have been run, and he really needs to conserve those brakes as much as possible so he'll have something at the end. Benny, a lot of flex in that tire there, too.
It's amazing to me. You see the car down the straightaway, how this tire, look at the down there. Watch the tire sidewall deflect as the car goes through the corner. And as he comes back off, it will straighten back up again. Tire's running true. And they go back in the corner, and watch as that tire tries to almost roll off the rim. Reflection in the sidewall on these cars.
We also have a camera mounted in the same position on the Budweiser car, Ricky Craven. Let's see if there's as much deflection and if the rotors are glowing as much as they are.
Well, they're turning pretty red, aren't they?
Yes. It looked like they're turning a little bit redder, but he is back in the traffic. Martin's kind of running out there, kind of running the speed he wants to run. You would expect Craven to be using a little bit more brake.
Does have Terry Labonte right on his rear spoiler, kind of pushing him along.
Those cars are running 29th and 30th, so when you're running back there, you know you're going to be using more brakes than the guy that's running in second place.
Sidewall deflection is just about the same on this car as it is on and there is Ward Burton, who has the lead back from Mark Martin. Most laps that Ward has led in one race was at the June Pocono race, where he was out front for a total of 60 laps. 47 completed here at Martinsville. Back in just a moment. Back at Martinsville Speedway in the Haynes 500, where Ward Burton continues to lead this race.
And Rusty Wallace trying to get by his brother, but you know, Ned, I was just thinking, Ward Burton did not run either race here, the last two races here at Martinsville. He may be using the brakes too much and just not realize how easy you have to be on the brakes.
That could be, because he doesn't have that experience the last couple of years, or last couple of races here. Here's the Wallace brothers racing side by side, or trying to be side by side.
And Chad Little is spun going in three, and the caution flag is out.
So on lap 54, the caution light out for the first time as Chad Little spins at the end of the backstretch.
And here we see Ward Burton coming by. He will take the caution flag.
Hey.
All right, talked about Ward Burton's inexperience here, but he has been very, very good here in a Busch Grand National car. In fact, he has won here in a Busch car before. So the crew not too concerned about the brakes. I just asked Chris Hussey, are you worried about the pace him using the brakes? And we reminded Ward, he said he knows this racetrack from the Busch days, and he'll be very good and very easy on the brakes. Let's check in with Bill.
Sterling Marlin lost a lot of positions. His car got very loose coming out of four. A lot of guys having that problem. Sterling got out of the gas, lost a lot of positions, got back in it. Now everybody comes down pit road.
Pit stops being made here as caution remains out for the first time. We go down to Jerry Punch once again.
35 miles an hour, nose to tail here. The front three cars sitting in the far end of pit road here in turn one. Right side jacket under both, all three cars. You see both Mark and Ward Burton. Pontiac number 22, Ford number 6. Left side tires going on to check in with Bill Weber.
Rusty Wallace is getting four tires. They have made a chassis adjustment right behind it. Nemechek is away. Rusty had to back up because he was squeezed in by the 98. Now pitches in front of the 23, which is followed out of the pits by the 99 and the 3.
And the 43 car pitting on the backstretch completes his work and goes onto the racetrack actually in the warm-up lane.
Yeah, and he's going to gain some positions too. He got over there quickly and comes out right behind Ward Burton.
Wow.
Don't know where he stood when he came across the line coming out of the pits, but when he got actually on the racetrack, he's right behind the the leader.
Another car who gained tremendously was the 40 car, Steve Park. Here we see the 97 get bumped from behind by Jeff Green and just turned head on into the wall from that little bump on the 29 car.
So Ward Burton comes out first. It'll be Bobby Hamilton second and Kenny Irwin third when we go back to racing in just a few moments. In less than a lap, we'll go back to racing after our first caution and our first set of pit stops.
And Kenny Irwin, the 27 car,
this car right there. They tried to roll the dice, just change right sides, getting back in front. But guess what? He gets blocked in by Rusty Wallace, the car in front of him. So the strategy goes down the tubes because he can't get out. As he does get out, Ward Burton rolls.
And from the crew cam being worn by Mitch Williams. Right there, you can see that he was blocked in momentarily. Still got out ahead of Mark as the green flies.
And Bobby Hamilton taking a look for the lead in three.
You can see how Hamilton got into second position. It was because of that pit stop that he made. Came in 14th, comes out second, and is trying to wrestle the lead away from Ward Burton. And also, Dale Jarrett had a great movement up through the field from 36th to 20th.
That was a two-tire change for DJ.
Right now, you would think that Ward Burton with four tires and these two cars behind them with two tires, that Ward Burton should be able to, in a few laps, start extending his lead on those two.
Jeff Gordon is running in sixth position. Battle for seventh is between Steve Park and Kenny Wallace.
Another guy who made a great movement on that pit stop was Steve Park. I'm sure getting on the back stretch, he only changed two tires. But we saw earlier, he has one of the fastest cars out here that Coors Light Chevrolet were talking about.
And Kenny staying up behind. Kenny's ahead of him. That's Hut Strickland working to the outside now of Steve Park.
Steve Park, the 40 car, was a driver of the NASCAR Featherlite Modified Tour. Here he is from Martinsville, Virginia. One year later, on the inside of Hut Strickland, Rusty Wallace right behind him. Pretty impressive.
And looking forward to a full slate of NASCAR Winston Cup races in 1998.
Well, we do have it confirmed that Hamilton only took two tires.
Got a little sideways off the corner that time, Benny, and lost a little momentum. Rusty Wallace to come up and challenge.
We're talking about all the guys that gained. Dale Earnhardt was up in 12th spot, I think, when the caution flag came out. He's now back in 16th spot, so he lost three or four spots on that caution flag, on that big change of pit stop. But again, most of the guys in front of him only changed two tires.
Some of those that were back had to just change two tires, but they'd have lost 11 pits. It was so long getting there.
Man, that is some good, close racing there from the onboard camera with Rusty Wallace. Well, Bobby Hamilton continues to try to get the lead away from Ward Burton as we have another spin. Down in turn number two, and looks like everybody's going to avoid him.
And here we come to the caution flag. Who will it be? It will be Hamilton.
By about a fender.
And Jimmy Spencer is trying to get started again. Put in first gear, nail the gas. Jimmy, go, baby. You got him.
Hamilton speeds up, trying to put him a lap down. Well, Spencer passed the pace car.
Yeah, but the pace car had to pick up the 43, and I think, you know, that the 43 had to pass him, in my opinion, before it would put him a lap down. Not the pace car, so we'll see.
The flagman, when he went by, just waved the caution flag at him, telling the cars in front of him. So, yes, Jimmy Spencer, I believe, is still in the lead lap and was told that by the NASCAR officials. Let's see if we can tell what happened. There we see Spencer on the inside of, on the outside of Steve Park as they go down in the corner. And Park just touches him in the left rear enough that Spencer goes for that spin cycle. Does a 360, stops the car. Now, these last Spencer will probably go in and change four tires, and as Shredder goes by on the outside.
And from the Pennzoil copter cam, the overhead shot. We have been watching these two running very close together from Rusty Wallace's onboard camera, and it got a little bit too close down in one.
Yeah, that was a situation where Spencer thought he was far enough in front of him that he could cut down and go his normal line going into the turn, and Park was a little farther up alongside than he thought he was and made contact, and around he goes.
This is from Ward Burton's Kmart onboard camera.
Or Jeff Burton, whoever.
Jeff Burton.
One of those Burton boys. Now we're going by the start-finish line. No, this is the backstretch, isn't it?
Nope, no, there's the flagman.
Yep.
And right there, we're going to see the contact. Come on, smoke. There we go. You knew there was smoke coming. Brett Bodine makes a pit stop on the back stretch.
And Spencer remains on the lead lap as Bobby Hamilton now has the lead of the race. Down to Jerry Punch.
Mark just radioed a moment ago that he wants the guys to go back to the air pressure they were talking about going back to. Apparently, they made a slight change in the air pressure in that first pit stop. He said now the car is just very, very tight and hard to get the turn here down in the corners. We are under caution after 71 of 500 laps are complete in the 49th running of the Haynes 500. Back with more from Martinsville in a moment.
Caution for four laps here at Martinsville, but now the green waves once again as Bobby Hamilton continues to lead. Ward Burton in second, Kenny Irwin Jr. in third, and in fourth position we have Joe Nemechek. And one guy on the move is Ricky Craven.
Ricky Craven's back in 12th spot, started 36th. So some pit strategy and a good running race car has him up there.
I would say that they just changed two tires, which was a good strategy, but he has passed some cars since the green came again. So, yeah, you're right, Benny. He does have a good car. And Kenny Irwin and Ward Burton get together here coming off of turn four. And that was about to be a spin.
Correct. It never happened. Huh? Yeah. Gordon, meanwhile, jumps to the outside.
He's on the outside of Mark Martin and will take that spot. And he's going to try to go by on the outside of Nemechek.
Nemechek bumping Kenny Irwin in turn four. Jeff Gordon still on the outside.
I'm amazed he's trying this on the outside. This is a NASCAR Winston Cup points leader on the outside. But it didn't work.
Well, he hasn't given up yet. He's going to try it up there again.
Kenny Wallace is staying right up there in the top groove with Jeff.
Now Jeff Gordon dives back to the inside and says, well, that didn't work out too well. Try a different strategy.
Jeff is in fifth spot.
Mr. Wallace moves to the inside of Mark Martin.
And like Jerry Punch talked about, Mark Martin is fighting his way towards the rear. Car's a little bit too tight.
He thought they had made an air pressure adjustment on it, but they said they didn't. This set of tires just simply a little bit tighter for you.
Jeff Burton moving up to the higher group, trying to get around Hunt Strickland.
Rusty bounced that left front off the curb that time. You saw him almost get the side of Kenny Wallace.
Well, that'd be a tough deal there at the dinner table, wouldn't it, Thanksgiving?
Now the outside line worked there for Jeff Burton as he picked up that spot from Hunt Strickland. Your overhead shots courtesy of the Pennzoil Copter Cam.
Now Rusty once again leans right on that left front fender of Kenny Wallace.
That helicopter has some beautiful blue sky to fly around in this afternoon as compared to a miserable rainy day.
What's this? What's this? Kenny Wallace driving on the outside of Jeff Gordon.
Well, he's been up there for quite a while, and it's worked for him. This time, he hasn't yet completed the pass of Gordon, but he's pretty close.
One thing he did, once he got up there, he took that line away that Jeff needed. He needed to drift out next to the wall coming off the turn. And so that killed a little bit of the momentum that he would have had going down the straightaway.
Now, if Kenny Irwin is holding his group up, well, that time Jeff Gordon was able to come off and use that line Ed was talking about.
Mike Skinner making an unscheduled pit stop in the Lowe's Chevrolet. He was running in there about the 20th position.
We have teammates battling together here on the racetrack at the moment. The 88 car of Dale Jarrett started at the back of the pack, and this is the battle for the 16th spot.
Ernie apparently changed four tires on that stop because he came out behind Jarrett and several others who just changed two tires.
And Bill Weber has an update on Chad Little, who hit the wall a few laps ago.
And Bob, they're hoping to get the John Deere Pontiac back out on the track. They're removing the nose. They're going to replace the radiator. So that's Chad Little's deal. As for Darrell Waltrip, it was two plug wires loose. They got those back on, but then they lost another lap. So they had to come back into the pits right before the race was restarted because they had put a left front tire on the right front. Also, briefly, Mike Skinner just made an unscheduled stop for tires here on the front stretch.
We saw Darrell Waltrip just a moment ago in that picture running competitive with those cars, so obviously he has his car is running again on eight cylinders. But he is three laps down. Darrell Waltrip, the Western Auto Chevy Parts America, three laps down while he's floundered around in with six cylinders.
Irwin leading this group of cars in third position. Nemechek right behind, then Gordon and Kenny Wallace. Kenny Irwin, of course, up from the USAC ranks where he has won two Silver Crown races in 1997, adding to his seven sprint car and eight midget wins in his career.
Taking a look at the Napa Field summary where all the cars currently are running on the racetrack. Only one car off the track. That is Chad Little. We saw his car just a moment ago as they worked trying to get it back on the racetrack. We have now run 91 laps. And Gordon, they look on the inside. I think Jeff Gordon is probably as fast as any car on the racetrack right now if he can get by these cars in front of him. Boy, this is a recipe for a crash there, isn't it, Ned?
Yes, it is. You haven't run that hard. Nemechek goes inside of Kenny Irwin. He tries to get back down in the inside groove, and he does. Gordon had to back off.
I think Jeff Gordon saw that 27 car was coming left, so he had to hit the brakes, and now he's going to try it on the outside.
Well, that's now he's going to dip down to the inside. Well, that didn't work either. And here comes Kenny Wallace up on the outside.
Jeff gets the fender in there in three and is going to take the spot.
I think right now that Kenny Wallace is going to try to dive to the inside. The gates may be open for Kenny Irwin right now.
Getting a lesson in short track racing here and how you can lose several positions in the flash of an eye.
When you get in this situation, you're using up a lot of brakes. And as all of these drivers are in this particular type situation, then you start stepping on the gas coming off of the corner, and your back end brakes loose, then you use up the tires. It's a tough situation.
Second lap in a row, it's been Joe Nemechek with the fastest lap in third place.
How about that?
The car ahead of you to take some pressure off the brakes.
Oh, yeah, every once in a while that happens because the two car goes in the corner and the 99 comes up and
boom.
Boom. But you see him trying to dodge the two car, he loses a spot to his teammate, Mark Martin.
Yep. Burton is in eighth spot. Mark Martin is ninth.
But Mark backed off and let Burton get back in front of him.
So Bobby Hamilton continues to lead here at Martinsville. In five races, he has five top tens, finished third last fall and second here in the spring. Back with more in a moment. The rain-delayed Haynes 500 from yesterday is underway here today with 102 laps completed at Martinsville. The leader of the race is Bobby Hamilton. Second is Ward Burton. Is Joe Nemechek. There is the leader of the race.
Not much going on up there where he is, but back here where this is, lots going on. Dale Earnhardt goes around Kenny Irwin. Now Mark Martin tries to go around. Kenny Irwin has had that car in every position imaginable and not has his fun out yet, Benny.
No, he isn't. Get some contact as these cars come up and just touch that level there like he did that time.
Hunt Strickland way out of shape.
That was Hunt that touched the left rear corner of Kenny Irwin that time, and both cars almost spun. And John Andretti dives to the outside of Hutton, the 98 car. And RCA car, that's another car that runs awfully well here at Martinsville.
Always does. John Andretti drives it well, and the car just seems to have a good setup, or the team has a good setup for the car.
He's in 11th position now, John Andretti is.
And we've got a great battle going on for third spot between Jeff Gordon and Joe Nemechek. Last time there's contact off the corner, all the fans jumped up, and Jeff Gordon's trying to do it the hard way on the outside. I think, well, that 24 car, the DuPont car, is fast.
He
He's trying to be as careful as he can, but at the same time, he's trying to get to the front.
He's been pretty aggressive, I think, for a guy who has is trying to protect the points lead.
You're right.
Now he's even with Nemechek down the straightaway.
Meanwhile, they're keeping up with Ward Burton, so that just, I think, indicates how well the 24 car is running. And I think, he's going to dive in the corner on the inside, but no, he'll probably do it down in turn one.
Kenny Wallace is also staying right there with Nemechek and Gordon finally makes the pass.
So Jeff Gordon moves into third spot.
And Kenny Wallace says, well, if you can do it, I might try, but then thought better of it.
Apparently, Ken Schrader found out way back in the field. He was moving backwards, and he's found the outside groove, and now he's beginning to move forward. So maybe that outside groove is pretty good right now, for some at least.
Here is Andretti going to the inside of Irwin. Now, when Kenny came here to test at Martinsville, they brought along Joe Ruttman, and one of the things they did on the track was send Joe out there and purposely bump and bang Kenny around out there so he would get an idea of just what it's like on race day.
Tell you what, he must have taught him well because he's been doing a great job.
Nemechek had the car totally sideways out of four last lap and now is trying to cling on to that fourth position as Kenny Wallace challenges.
He's got Rusty Wallace right behind him.
Boy, look there. Dale Earnhardt has caught that group of cars. He was like 17th or something, 16th or 17th when the green flag came back out after the pit stops, and he is up to eighth place now.
Here's Nemechek coming off the corner, and he almost loses it, but he gets back off the throttle and. Right, and Kenny Wallace drives on the outside. Jerry Punch?
On that, you're exactly right. Earnhardt was 17th when the restart came out. He is now in eighth position. They made an air pressure adjustment to try to loosen the car up in the middle of the turn. And that time by, Earnhardt clocked a lap at 20.98 seconds. According to the computerized clock, the leader, the 43 car, is running 21.1.
Earnhardt is showing a little bit of damage there on the front of the car, just how hard he's been racing here in the first 113 laps.
There he moves around the 99 car of Jeff Burton, takes another position,
puts him up to sixth. Nemechek has lost several positions here in the last few laps.
Irwin has found his way back to the 12th spot, and Ricky Rudd is right on his back bumper, and there's four more cars behind Ricky Rudd. So once again, if he slips up and Rudd gets on the inside, the door will be open.
And a spin crash here on the main straightaway. It's two cars, Terry Cope and Robert Presley, have damage to their cars. Presley goes to the warm-up lane down in turn one. Cope remaining on the racetrack, but there's damage to the right front of both cars.
Wow, look at the tire on Jerry Cope's car. It's almost knocked off, completely off the car. And fortunately, he's able to get the car behind pit wall. Yeah, the right front tire is just riding along. It's not hooked to anything much.
Caution is out once again here at Martinsville. And we'll see some pit stops here momentarily as Robert Presley has successfully made it to
the Look pit at this. Area. Jeff Gordon is in second spot.
Yeah.
He got by Ward Burton. I didn't see that happen.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he didn't make a pit stop. Kenny Irwin and Jeff Burton are coming into the pits.
And Jeff Gordon stayed out.
That's Irwin making his way slowly down to his pits. Now he finds his pit stall. Remember, he only took two tires on that first pit stop that he had, and now they go to the right side and make a change.
So they will change four tires this time. The right sides are almost done. Yep, Jack comes around to the left side.
Sterling Marlin pulls out. Dale Jarrett is also on pit road. Jeff Burton is also rolling from his pit stop. And we have some cars also pitting on the back stretch. but nobody else here on the main straightaway, as track position is important at this point of the race. It is Hamilton, Gordon, then Ward Burton, Kenny Wallace, and Rusty Wallace, the top five at Martinsville. Caution is still out here in Martinsville, Virginia, where Bobby Hamilton is lined up right behind the pace car. Let's show you why we're under caution here.
Okay, folks, if you watch this spot right back here, you'll see Robert Preston, the second car, come off the corner, and all of a sudden, the car just veers straight right. And Derek Cole comes along with no place to go and runs over the left rear.
Jerry is with Robert Presley.
Well, heavy damage to the right side of the Jasper engines forward, and Robert, the car looked like it went right into the wall. What happened?
I think a brake just got hot on the bead of the tire and blowed it out coming off forward, and it just got right in the wall, nothing we could do. But just glad, you know, this Jasper Ford running good, Federal Mogul, and thought we had a good car today, just sitting there riding, but we're out early now.
Any warning at all that the pedal get soft on you?
No, I never did, just coming out four there. The car just shot right in the wall. I thought somebody's on the outside, but as soon as I hit, they said tire went down, so nobody hit me for nothing.
All right, it can happen just that fast here at Martinsville. Let's check in with Bill Weber on the 43 situation of Bobby Hamilton.
Well, here on the backstretch, Robbie Loomis, the crew chief, and the rest of the STP bunch are pretty thrilled. They didn't stop under this caution. They said their tire temperatures and tire wear were both good after their first stop. Robbie said the gear they have in that car is helping to slow Bobby down. The fact that he's in front means he's not using as much of his brakes if he was back in the pack. And also, he said Bobby Hamilton is light-footed on those brakes anyway. So everything looks good right now for the STP Pontiac pitting on the backstretch.
Bobby Hamilton had his best finish of 1997, a second in the first Martinsville race here this spring. Back in a moment. Green is back out here at Martinsville as Bobby Hamilton continues to show the way. Best battle on the racetrack right now involves the Wallace boys, Kenny and Rusty, and also there is the 31 of Mike Skinner. However, he is a lap down.
Skinner had made an unscheduled pit stop for a change of tires.
There in Skinner's car, and that was caused when he hit Rusty in the back end just a few minutes ago.
Now Rusty's trying to get by his brother Kenny, and Kenny's trying to get by the Ward Bird car, the 22 car. Pretty interesting little struggle here.
Watching all this is Dale Earnhardt.
And Mike Skinner going to go find his watch and go to the two car.
Little paint trading.
You see Skinner really using the brakes hard as he tries to fight his way back to the front. Get back on the lead lap. You see the cars go down the corner, you see that nose just die after the earth. You know they're really standing on the brakes hard.
Earnhardt's going to stick his nose up under there too. He sees a little bit of an opening. But he couldn't make it that out.
Well, Jeff Gordon has now caught the leader of the race, Bobby Hamilton.
Now he's exactly where he wants to be. He's just going to ride there and wait for an opening like this.
Yeah, he wants those five bonus points. He knows that Mark Martin already has five bonus points for leading a lap, for leading more than one lap. But...
And you can see there's 368 laps to go, so Jeff Gordon can easily lead the most laps. And Bobby Hamilton didn't fight that hard. He saw that Jeff Gordon had a faster car. Hand came out the window and said, okay, Jeff, you're here, you're fast, go.
So Gordon now gets five bonus points. We'll see who's the fastest car on the racetrack at the moment. Looks like it could be, well, it's Jeff Burton. It was for a long time.
Well, he came in and got four tires during that caution flag. So even though he's running back in traffic, he's still turning some good laps.
Ernie was the second fastest. Now we'll do it again. Jeff Burton still the fastest, and Kenny Irwin Jr. second. Down to Jerry Punch with a further report on Robert Presley's car.
You heard Robert Presley tell you that the brakes got so hot they melted the bead on the tire. Let me show you what he's talking about. The bead is actually this margin on the inside of the tire where when it inflates, it hooks underneath this wheel. How the wheel is hot. That's the bead of the tire. And the brakes got so hot, you see how this inside of the wheel is charred from the brake dust, that it melted this bead and allowed the tire to separate from the wheel, and thus he went directly in to the outside wall.
And it came off at the worst place, coming off the turn.
And we'll go back to one of the onboard cameras, and you see, this is the area that Jerry's talking about, the bead of the tire where it goes on the wheel. And we see when Mark Martin goes down the corner and applies the brakes, how red that rotor gets. Imagine the temperature that inside that tire is feeling. And obviously, the tire on Robert Presley's car felt too much, and it blew out. That's Mark Martin's. Let's go back to the 25 car, Ricky Craven, as he tries to fight his way to the front. And we'll see if we can... Man, I'm impressed. The brake rotor is pretty cool on Craven's car. As he goes to the corner and hits the brakes, you can see that it does heat up somewhat.
Ricky's to the inside of Steve Grissom as they battle for the...
We got a spin coming off turn two. Jeff Bodine, the 90 car, Dick Trickle was involved, and I think the 46 car also was involved.
Bodine going the wrong way down the backstretch, facing oncoming traffic. And Skinner got his lap back. How
well,
about
maybe one of them.
I think he was only down one.
Okay.
Yeah. We see the 46 car runs across. One of the cars involved. Right front has some damage on the 46 car. The 90 car also has damage to the right front. And I think Jeff O'Neill's car had damage to the left front. There we see the right front tire flat on Wally Dahlenbach's car.
And there's Dick Trickle.
A lot of smoke coming from his car, and you can see where it comes from there.
Jack it up, pull that tire off, have another tire ready. Grab one
front
and up
and the left rear damaged.
I guess the left front is where he had most damage. Now pit stop starting.
The Jerry Punch.
All right, they had a difficult decision deciding whether to come in or not. They could go to lap 220. Jeff Gordon pitting right in front of Dale Earnhardt is right in front of John Andretti. Right side tire is going on Gordon's car. They were talking about making a slight chassis adjustment. Thus far, they have not made one. Left front, left rear going on. And the 24 may be blocked. He can make it out. He just doesn't get by. Going right out in front of Rusty Wallace as they head down the turn one. Let's check in the
Bobby has the STP Pontiac in what would be the number one pit stall if this was the front stretch. He will exit right across the line. Already right side tires, now left side tires. Field roars by. Hamilton getting fuel. Storing on the left side, tightening the hogs. Hamilton is down and away. Beats Ernie Irvin, the 29 and the 16 out of the pit.
We talked about it yesterday in our show. And a rainout show just how much, what kind of difficulties you have hitting on the backstretch. Bobby Hamilton goes in running where? In second place and comes out. He will be lucky to be in the top 20.
So the standings are going to scramble here because of this series of pit stops. We're going to take a break and be back in just a moment to the Haynes 500 in Martinsville. Quaker State, the quality your car deserves. Here's Jerry Punch.
At tracks, we use a lot of brakes. Brake dust can become a major factor. Let me show you this wheel. This is the inside of the one of the wheels. You see what I have on my finger? Folks, that is brake dust, but that's not a whole lot of brake dust. Ordinarily, at a lot of short tracks, you can't even see the red paint on the inside of the wheel. How do they keep the brake dust off? Well, they basically spray the inside of the wheel with a cooking lubricant. You got to use something that's accustomed to high temperatures, so they use PAM. They spray the inside of the wheel with PAM. The dust does come off, but it will not stick. It falls off. Therefore, when they come in for a pit stop, there isn't a lot of dust or a lot of debris in the crew member's face. Green flag.
The leader of the race is Jeff Burton. Now, the 37 car of Jeremy Mayfield is at the tail end of the lead lap, and Darrell Waltrip was actually at the front of this line, is two laps down.
Those first three cars of Jeff Burton, Kenny Irwin, and Dale Jarrett had just stopped about 20 laps ago. So they did these stops.
And we have Rick Mast, Ricky Craven, Blake Steve Grissom.
And I think they also had all stopped at that time.
This is the Kmart in-car camera shooting the Kmart race car driven by Mayfield. The 99 carrying the Kmart onboard camera.
See Jeff Burton trying to get around Jeremy Mayfield. Jeremy had a problem with that Kmart Ford the last time. Really struggled. Lost a lap, and now he's trying his best to get it back. Jeff Gordon trying to get by Ricky Rudd.
Made the pass on the outside, and here comes Rusty Wallace. He's trying that same thing, taking over the 10th position Rusty does. Gordon just moved in tonight. Well, Rusty hadn't quite made the pass yet. Matt looks like he will.
And Ned was talking about using all the racetrack. Watches these guys come off the corner. They really make a wide arc down in the corner, right to the bottom of the racetrack, and watch as Rusty comes off the corner, right up against that outside retaining wall. And when you can't do that, you lose a tremendous amount of momentum.
Good shots from the overhead Pennzoil copter cam. Had some great flying weather for that helicopter today. Unlike yesterday. Now, Jeff Gordon moving to the outside of David Green, or at least taking a look to the outside.
This is Bobby Labonte's Food Lion on board camera as he is behind Ricky Rudd.
And a side-by-side battle between Ricky Craven and Dale Jarrett for third.
And Rick Mast trying to take over fourth as he comes off the corner on the inside of Jarrett. And, you know, I talked about Bobby Hamilton just before the break, the STP Pontiac, and what a tough break he had pitting on the backstretch. He went in the end running second. He came out running 23rd. He now has moved back up to 22nd.
Also might mention that Hut Strickland lost a lap. He's back in 35th. He had to come in for a loose lug nut. Bill Weber is with Wally Dahlenbeck.
And he sits in the first Union Chevy. Son Jack's behind the wall. What happened, Wally?
Well, we were just running long. I was trying to get around the 90 car, having a little tough time of it, so I thought I'd let Jeff give it a shot. And he got by him, but that's not what I had in mind.
Well, he still sits in the car. They've got significant damage to the right front wheel assembly. So they'll be back here for a while. Meanwhile, Chad Little rolling by. He'll go back out on the track in a modified John Deere Pontiac.
I think what Wally was saying was that Jeff Bodine in the 7 car and the 90 car made contact, and both those cars spun, and Dahlenbeck hit one.
He said he had nowhere to go. Yeah, I think that's what he was saying.
Napa Field summary. Lake Speed up in 6th position from a 24 start in Grissom to 7th after starting 40th. But again, some of these cars up here in the top 10 are off sequence in terms of pit stops. There's Mark Martin running back in the 13th spot.
Bobby, you need help. Just, you know, say something. We'll be glad to help you out there, buddy.
I know you're always right behind me.
Yes, sir.
Larry Cope is back out on the racetrack.
So Chad Little back out making a few laps around the racetrack, obviously not at the speed.
Just as I said, that Greg Cook pulls his Skittles Pontiac back behind the wall again.
You notice Kenny Wallace back there in 31st position. He also had to come in again for a flat left rear. And Ricky Craven is up to 3rd position.
Jeff Burton's been able to get by the 37 car, put that lap car between the second place car of Kenny Irwin and the third place car of Ricky Craven.
A battle for position as Dale Earnhardt and Ward Burton are trying to decide who should run 16th, and Earnhardt goes to the bottom.
The 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th.
John Benson in the Pennzoil Pontiac right behind him in the yellow car. And the McDonald's Ford right behind them.
Earnhardt makes the pass. Now Benson's going to try to do the same thing.
Johnny Benson will join the Jack Roush operation in 1998.
There's Bobby Hamilton that I was talking about just a moment ago. Man, that back pit is so tough because all the 21 cars on the front pit come in the pits, do their tire changes, and then the guys on the back go in the pits. NASCAR does all they can. They speed up the pace car trying to get these guys on the back pits in sooner, but obviously it didn't work out for Bobby Hamilton that time.
When you've got as fast a car as Bobby Hamilton does, and you know you can move up, it sometimes gets frustrating and even dangerous trying to move up through that traffic.
Boy, look at Jimmy Spencer, almost lost it. He's in the yellow and purple number 23.
And there is Hut Strickland there at the back of this group. We told you he had to come in a second time and tighten a loose lug nut. His onboard camera, we look up ahead to Ernie Irvin. It's Jeff Burton leading Kenny Irvin Jr., Ricky Craven, Rick Mast, and Dale Jarrett in the Haynes 500 with 164 laps complete. Welcome back to Martinsville Speedway in Virginia. The Haynes 500 being led by Jeff Burton. We're riding with him looking, well, we were looking back on Darrell Waltrip, but
who just passed the leader.
That's right. Well, Wednesday night at 9:30 on ESPN2, the NASCAR Featherlite Modified Tour heads into Stafford Springs, Connecticut for the CarQuest 300. You can see it at 9:30 Eastern Time Wednesday night over on the Deuce. There is Burton, the leader of the race, got about a 1.5 second lead on Kenny Irvin.
Jimmy Spencer just a moment ago came off the corner, was a little bit loose. Let's watch the exploits of Mr. Excitement this time as he comes off the corner behind the 43 car, and he grazes the wall ever so gently as he exits the corner.
Doesn't feel too gently when you're in that car and come off that wall. You wonder if you knocked the quarter panel in against the tire, but apparently he didn't. He's still out there going pretty strong.
He's 20th.
This is the leader of the race, Jeff Burton, the X-Side Batteries Ford. Darrell Waltrip on passing. Now, two left behind the leader. Had a couple of plug wires loose at the start of the race.
Here's Jeff Gordon and Rick Mast battling for the fourth position, and Gordon gets it rather easily.
Yeah, he's coming on up through there pretty good. I think he's gaining on the leader. For a little while, Jeff Burton was really setting a blistering pace out there, but don't know if he had to slow down a little bit. His lap speeds in the last little while, he'd gone from about 91.5 miles an hour down to about 89.9 now, which is about 0.3 seconds.
Let's check the speeds out this time by, Ned, and we'll just find out how we're doing as we see Jeff Burton go by it, 89 miles per hour, and Jeff Gordon 90.4. So yes, Ned, he is the fastest car on the racetrack right now. And back to Steve Park once again, the second fastest car. That 40 car is really fast.
He has been consistently among the fastest cars regardless of where he's running.
All he needs is track position and he would be good to go.
Yep.
But the 40 car is back, is buried back there.
There is Park. He's showing a little bit of damage there on the right side.
He don't mind getting in there and mixing it up.
He's back in 20th spot as he goes by John Andretti. Look at that groove. He's running the groove entirely foreign to everyone else. He's running much higher around the racetrack, and it's working for him. He passed the 98 car with ease on the outside. Knight dives back to the inside. That time, Jeff Burton was a little faster than. Check it out once more. Jeff Gordon over 90 miles per hour. Rick Mast over 90 miles per hour. And that time, the 40 car in traffic was a little bit slower. And look at them trying to go by the 43 car who led this race.
Wonder if this set of tires maybe is not quite as good as me, Steve. Better back off, and he did. Wasn't smart to go in there three wide. That set of tires maybe not quite as good as Earnhardt and Joe Nemechek battle side by side.
Battle for 15th spot.
And some contact.
Bill Elliott right behind him.
McConnell's car.
Dale Earnhardt has won six times here at Martinsville, and Jeff Gordon takes over second position from Kenny Irwin.
Irwin.
That's going to be tough next year when we have those guys every race. Kenny Irwin and Ernie Irvin. So Kenny Irwin goes back to third spot as Jeff Gordon has second, and he's about 2 seconds behind the leader, Jeff Burton. We'll keep an eye on that interval and see if he's able to close in. But another impressive performance here in the first 180 laps, at least, for Kenny Irwin. And here comes Rusty Wallace to the inside of Rick Mast, trying to take over fifth spot.
Rick moves up, gives him plenty of room coming off the turn. Now Rick will back off going into turn three and let Rusty go.
Now is definitely not the time to be hoggish over real estate.
Good words, Mr. Parsons.
Lots of racing to do here. Haven't even passed the 200 lap mark yet.
Still over 300 laps to run here at Martinsville. A lot can happen.
It usually does.
Exactly.
Just ahead of this group, Ricky Craven, number 25, the Budweiser car. He's running in fourth spot. About 3.2 seconds behind Jeff Burton. Here's Joe Nemechek.
Bunch of Chevrolet Monte Carlo trying to knock the nose pieces off. That's a battle for the 14th spot between Earnhardt and Sterling Marlin. Nemechek's back there as well. His driver protector, Steve Park, drive to the inside of the 94 car, but not able to make that pass.
Jeff Gordon is whittling away at the lead that Jeff Burton has.
Here comes the leaders. There we see the 99 car, and there is Jeff Gordon. Take a look at the AutoZone track interval. The last five laps, we see that Jeff Gordon was 2.3 seconds behind Jeff Burton. And in five laps, he closed it up 6/10 of a second, a little over a half second.
And Jeff Gordon was the fastest among the top six last lap. And now Burton has a little bit of traffic to contend with as he passes the new papa, Michael Waltrip, whose wife, Buffy, gave birth to a baby girl last night. Let's take a break and be back in just a moment with more of the Haynes 500 from Martinsville. It's still Jeff Burton on top. ESPN Speed World coverage today in Martinsville, Virginia for the Haynes 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race being brought to you by Kmart. Get the X-Side NASCAR Select battery at Kmart. NASCAR performance at Kmart, low prices. By Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? By Brewery Fresh Budweiser, the king of beers. Hey, race fans, this Bud's for you. And by McDonald's, the official drive-through of NASCAR. There is a look at the paperclip-shaped Martinsville Speedway, courtesy of the Pennzoil copter cam hovering overhead.
Kyle Petty, Darrell Waltrip, trying to stay in front of the leader. Their leader, Jeff Burton, the 99 car. Bill Weber has something to add.
Well, Benny, Jeff Burton is leading the race, but he's not racing Jeff Gordon. He is in a conservation mode designed to save his brakes and his tires. Basically, he's racing the stopwatch. Crew chief Buddy Parrott is calling out his lap time. So they're not concerned with the cars catching him. Right now, they're concerned about that X-Side Ford being competitive on lap 499.
Probably a pretty good strategy, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a very good strategy.
Battle between Kenny Irwin and Rusty Wallace.
Lead for the third position. Irwin has it. Rusty has been coming up on him.
Kenny Irwin, I would really struggle with Robert Yates' decision to put this kid in the car, but he has been so impressive the first couple of races. I felt like Kenny Irwin, the driver of the 28 car in 1998.
And he's been impressive on some pretty tough racetracks, too.
Rusty now trying to go to the outside.
See that 21 car, Michael Walter, that's the Wood Brothers car.
Steve Grissom, 40 is off the pace, Steve Park, and so is Steve Grissom. Steve Grissom is headed to the pits on the back stretch, and now Steve Park heads to the pits on the back stretch.
Well, he has been one of the fastest cars consistently throughout the race, but something has gone wrong, and Park brings the car to the back stretch pit. Jerry?
On the radio a moment ago, Steve said, I think we just blew the engine. I'm headed for the pits as we have a lead change. Jeff Gordon will make a move and go around Jeff Burton. And by the way, on the 41 car, Steve Grissom, he likewise a lap ago started trailing a lot of smoke. NASCAR was about to black flag to 41 when he abruptly slowed to head for pit road.
So as work goes on those two cars, we see that Jeff Gordon has indeed Jeff Burton, and Burton was a little loose coming off the corner.
Yeah, I think he got on the gas a little too hard coming off that corner and broke the right rear loose. And that's something that he doesn't want to do too much, and he'll be careful not to do it again, because if you break that right rear too many times loose and spin that wheel, Benny, it'll heat those tires up in a hurry.
If we heat that right rear tire up, it'll start building air pressure. Rusty Wallace, Kenny Irwin make contact off the corner. Like you said a moment ago, that's third and fourth, and Rusty is trying to take third away.
Michael Waltrip and
Rick Mast
down in turn one, between turns one and two. Caution coming out again.
I saw the 25 car get sideways. I thought someone had lost some fluid there, but I guess he was trying to dodge these two cars is why he almost spun. I'm talking about the 25 car of Ricky Craven. And Rick Mast had a great run going. We see some damage to the left rear corner, but he will stay in the lead lap.
He was running in the sixth position.
Fifth caution of the day, just past the 200 lap mark. Let's take a look at it on the replay, see what happened.
Ever seen Ricky Craven, and the 21 car goes in there and hits the curb and trying to dodge to keep from spinning out the 25 car. He spun himself out and hit. Dale just missed that crash.
He did. He might have seen it coming and really had to slow down very quick. Let's go to the pits and Bill Weber.
Here is the race leader, Jeff Burton, on pit road. This is expected to be a four-tire change on the XI4. They've got the right sides on, very tight pitch. Burton has stopped short, should have no problem exiting. Jerry Punch is further down pit road. Further work going on. Jerry.
All right, Jeff Gordon made only a right side tire change, but almost got T-boned by Kenny Schrader. Gordon pissed off so quickly, he was pulling out. Schrader was coming in. Now Schrader is in. He has to back up because he is blocked in by Kenny Wallace. Martin is in. Martin has to back up. It is just that tight here in the pit that Martin will some valuable time being lost because of congestion.
Kenny Irwin Jr. having all kinds of problems in the pit area. He is the last one out of the pits. Let's take a look at the Bud in-car camera on this incident up in one and two.
See, Michael hit the inside curbing, upset the car. Over he went into the 25 car of Craven, and then the car number 75, of course, got into it. Rick Mast had nowhere to go when Michael spun right up in front of him.
205 laps completed in the Haynes 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race. It's Jeff Gordon and Rusty Wallace, one and two now, under caution. Bob Jenkins, Benny Parsons, Ned Jarrett, Bill Weber and Dr. Jerry Punch back at Martinsville Speedway in Virginia. We're under caution for the fifth time this afternoon on the 208th lap as Jeff Gordon has the lead and Rusty Wallace is second. Coming out in third position would be Jeff Burton. Dale Earnhardt is going to be fourth and Ken Schrader will be fifth when we go back to racing. On the last 25 races on the short tracks, look at the statistics regarding Jeff Gordon and Rusty Wallace. They both have seven wins. Rusty has the advantage in top fives. They both have top tens the same. And Jeff Gordon has earned a few more NASCAR Winston Cup points. That's on the last 25 races on tracks that are a mile or less.
Well, that's amazingly close.
It is. Steve Grissom lost an engine on the Kodiak Chevrolet. He's through for the day, as well as Steve Park.
being set to go back to racing. Darrell Waltrip will line up to the inside of Jeff Burton. Waltrip is two laps down. He did get one of them back.
Still 27 cars on the lead lap. Ready.
Driver who gave it a heck of a run and was among the fastest cars out there all afternoon, Steve Park, is out of the race. Jerry?
Well, Bob, from 28th to 10th, what a run for this young man. Steve, you had a great effort going, but what put you out?
I'll tell you what, the car's light. Chevrolet Monte Carlo was running good. We needed another pit stop to get it right, and we just started to run hot. I don't know if we got the nose banged in or got some rubber packed up on the front of it, and it was just a matter of time before the motor let go.
All right, Rusty Wallace running side by side with Jeff Gordon. Now you can relax and watch the boss man try to win one.
Yeah, he looks like he's running good. We're hoping we can get up there and run with them guys, but I guess not today. So now we'll just have to cheer on the black number three car and hope the boss man does a good job.
All right, Steve Park had a great effort, but he came up short. Now we'll watch and see if possibly the 99 car can make a run on Jeff Gordon.
Jeff is trying all the time. Jeff Gordon, Rusty Wallace has taken the lead. Dale Earnhardt, Steve's boss, runs in fourth place now. There is the lap car put Strickland between Jeff Burton and Dale Earnhardt. This is the onboard from Jeff Burton. You can see how close he is to second spot.
See how Strickland, the Circuit City car, he is a lap down, had a bad pit stop or something, lost a lap.
Yeah, he had to come back into the pits to tighten up some lug nuts.
He's running in 28th position, first car not on the lead lap.
There you see the top 10 cars, Bill Elliott in 10th spot.
Board with Hut Strickland. Here's a Napa field summary. Now, when you see Dale Jarrett there in sixth position and the number in parentheses 21st, well, that was his official starting position, but remember, he actually started this race from the very back of the pack because he had to go to a backup car after qualifying when his main car caught fire Saturday morning.
Yeah, he had a marshmallow roast here on Saturday morning. His car was a marshmallow.
It sure was. Well, Rusty has really lengthened the lead as we see Ricky Craven and Ricky Rudd battling for eighth position.
They're all sort of backed up behind Mark Martin and Dale Jarrett and Kenny Schrader. Schrader ran on the outside of Darrell Walter for about four laps trying to put a lap on him. Darrell finally just went on from down on the inside, and that really bunched the cars up. And with this battle right here continues to go on, it is for the position.
Just updating you on other drivers. Four-time winner here at Martinsville, Jeff Bodine, was involved in an incident earlier. He's now three laps down in 35th position.
Ricky Craven got by Ricky Rudd that time. I was wondering if he was able to use heating up that brake rotor, but it doesn't look like he was. Well, it's pretty red now, but he is back to the inside, which ought to help his situation. Goes out of the corner, and that brake rotor turns cherry red.
We learned during happy hour, Benny, I remember that teams will say if the rotor stays 1,000 degrees or less, it's okay, but anything above that is in the danger zone.
He's moved back to the outside. He's going to try to take a look on the outside of Martin. Let's see how much, if he gets any redder as he tries to run the outside groove. Now that comes back to the inside. And we can see where the car got a little bit sideways off the corner. Saw that right front tire back and forth. That was to side, try to correct a sliding problem. I'm just amazed at the deflection in these sidewalls on these tires.
Well, they could be.
There see Ricky Craven's car behind Martin Martin in front of Ricky Rudd. We're riding along with him. Onboard camera.
I said a moment ago that Kenny Schrader and Darrell Walker were racing side by side. Darrell had driven off and lift Kenny Schrader. In fact, he's gone up and passed Dale Earnhardt. So Walker is really running fast right now. But he is two laps down.
Now, a driver in a car that had been running up front most of the race but is no longer is Kenny Irwin in car number 27. He had a bad pit stop last time and has come out in 25th position and struggling to pass cars in the field. Jerry?
Well, actually, Bob, it wasn't human error that cost him all those spots. They had a jack brake on the pit stop on the car number 27. They're trying to put this crew together a lot for next year for the David Blair team. They were having a good stop, but the jack broke. They had to drop him down off the jack, let him go around the track, racetrack, and he had to come back in again. Well, they went and got another jack. That's what cost him about 18 spots on that last pit stop.
And he's running right behind the pole sitter of the Haynes 500 in 24th position, Ward Burton, car 22. Ward, the only driver eligible for $7,600 in Unical bonus money. That, of course, goes back to the least amount as a result of last week's win by pole sitter Mark Martin.
Wally Dallenbeck coming back on the racetrack after some repairs his car. They crashed off turn two with the 90 car Dick Trickle and the 7 of Jeff Bonine.
Running in fourth position, almost 6 seconds behind the leader, Rusty Wallace, is Dale Earnhardt. It's been a pretty good race for him, although there have been some ups and downs. Here was a down moment off the corner, turn four, scraping the wall as he came down the front straightaway. We'll be right back. As we come back, we have a crash in the backstretch. Kenny Irwin Jr. slides into Dick Trickle, who was stopped in the middle of the racetrack. John Andretti, Sterling Marlin also involved.
And Terry Labonte got involved in it as well.
I'm going to the truck with Todd.
They'll learn.
Sorry, Dick.
Boy, Irwin slid into Trickle, and they collided very hard.
Trickle had just come back out of the track after being behind the wall for about 90 laps. I don't know what the start of this is, but you can see there's damage to the rear of the Kenny Irwin car. You can see the right front tire is flat on his car.
It's our sixth caution of the day. Here's a replay of what happened over the backstretch.
No, that's not what happened on the backstretch. Here's what happened on the backstretch. They come off the corner, and I guess the 90 car got some contact from the 97 car, but he goes right across the racetrack in front of the 4 car, and the racetrack now just gets blocked as John Andretti spins to dodge all this stuff, and the cars come along, and we saw Kenny Irwin there.
There is his contact.
He slides into the 4 car.
Yeah, I think that was Bobby Labonte in the 18 car, the green car, that made the initial contact.
Okay, I gave the wrong guy the brain. We'll watch this from the onboard, from the copter cam, and watch all these cars just stop, trying their best to get through. There we see Irwin gets the contact from the 5 car, there is the 97 car driving up right there, Ned, so you're right. It was not Chad Little.
Sterling is in. Here's Bill Weber.
And they have put right side tires on the Kodak Chevrolet. They're pulling sheet metal away from the right front and working on the right rear. So Sterling Marlin's got some damage. He's also got some damage on the left rear quarter panel. Jerry.
Kenny Irwin in likewise, Bill, has damage at all four corners. They used an electric saw to cut the rear bumper away. Some of that was fiberglass. They just cut that away, try to pull some fenders away. I got to believe he'll come back in. They were just mainly checking the toe in the front. They wanted a young man to experience all of what Martinville is about. I think he just did.
Yeah, he's gotten a real lesson in NASCAR Winston Cup short track racing here today. Kenny Irwin involved in this latest incident. We'll be back in just a moment. Caution still out here at Martinsville Speedway in the Haynes 500. Near the halfway mark, we've completed 240 laps. Well, at 7:30 tonight here on ESPN, tune in to NFL Prime Monday as host Mike Tirico and his team tackle all the big stories from yesterday's matchups and then they will give you an in-depth preview of the Monday night football game over on ABC tonight, featuring the San Francisco 49ers and the Carolina Panthers. That's at 9 o'clock Eastern time on ABC's Monday night football. So Charlotte will come alive tonight, huh, for that
game? Yes, it will. Go Panthers. Tonight at 8 or 9. 8.
Down to Bill Weber.
And John Andretti sits on pit road. He's got heavy damage to the front of his RCA 4. They're reaching in through the grill. They put a couple of giant tape-sized band-aids on this car to try and keep the hood in position. Now they're pulling some sheet metal away, trying to bend the hood and make sure it will latch. We'll check the tow in, make sure the car handles okay, but John Andretti's going to have a long afternoon for the last 250 laps.
And that's a shame, because John Andretti had a very good race car. Once again, here's why we're on caution flag. The 18 car, Bobby Labonte and Dick Trickle, the 90, makes some contact. Trickle goes back across the racetrack. Sterling Marlin has no place to go. The 98 car, no place to go. And
Bobby Hamilton weaved his way through there. Ernie Irvin, too.
And right there, someplace, there was Kenny Irwin. He could make some contact with Cherry Labonte as he tries to go through there. Labonte gets through, but Kenny Irwin goes in the back of the 90 car.
Labonte does have some damage, and he's a lap down in 31st position. Well, Terry has been named the third quarter nominee for the NASCAR True Value Man of the Year Award. True Value is sponsoring the Man of the Year Award, awarding $50,000 to a driver who illustrates superiority both on and off the racetrack. Terry's favorite charity, of course, the National Bone Marrow Foundation, which you can contact by dialing 1-800-MARROW-2. Congratulations to Terry Labonte. The green flag is out. We're back to racing.
You see Bobby Labonte down on the inside. He's a lap down. I don't know how he got that lap down. I didn't think that he got in the accident, but maybe he lost a lap in the pit. I don't know what the deal was.
Rusty Wallace went around Jeff Gordon during that long green period we just had. Rusty pulled away rather easily from Jeff. We're going to see if that happens this time. Here is Dale Earnhardt, who is running in fourth position. Bill Weber is with Dick Trickle, who was involved in that crash over on the backstretch.
Well, Dick Trickle is here behind the wall. Tough day for you, Dick. What happened the last time?
Well, we're just getting running there a little bit. You know, the guys got the car back together. Trying to get up to speed to find a place in line. And somebody got in the back of me coming off of two. So, you know, either two of them or something going on. I got hit twice here today. We come out, we're just trying to find a place to run. The guys did a terrific job. You know, we got some good races coming up. I expect to have some good run.
Okay, that's Dick Trickle. He's finished for today. He'll be back next week at Charlotte. Not a Sports Center day for Dick.
Dick Trickle's best finish here was third in this race in 1989.
Dick Trickle wanted to know what happened. Here's what happened. Bobby Labonte's right beside of him, and a little bit of contact, and around goes Dick Trickle.
Ricky Craven, along with Ken Schrader and Darrell Waltrip, who remains two laps down, but Craven is in fifth and Schrader in sixth.
Craven just took that position away.
Darrell had that problem at the drop of the green flag, and when they got it fixed, that car has been pretty competitive.
He has been running very good since then.
You wondered about Bobby Labonte being a lap down, Ned. Bill Weber has the answer.
Benny lost it on pit road with an alternator problem on the Interstate Battery Chevrolet. So Bobby Labonte, Pontiac, old habits die hard. But Bobby Labonte, an alternator problem. That's why he lost the lap on pit road.
There's the 18th car, the Interstate Battery Pontiac.
He's in 25th position, one lap down.
Here's a Napa field summary for you again.
As we go by 25, check and see if Ned's right, folks, on the Napa field summary.
I bet he is.
That is going to show that there are 23 cars on the lead lap.
Every time we have one of them wrecks, we lose a few off the lead lap.
Yep. Here is Bobby Labonte in 25th, the lap down.
Right again, Ned.
Yeah. Well, it's amazing how right you can be when you look up here at this computer.
Don't give away our secrets. Sterling Marlin is now off the racetrack, getting repairs. Grissom is out of the race, so is Steve Park. And Robert Presley is off the track while Trickle is out of the race. Well, Jeff Gordon has settled into second position, and he seems rather content there.
You know, I said at the top of the show, Bob, that it was hard to find a place on a track like this that you could just sit there and ride and not have to worry about cars around you, in front of you, or beside it. He's found him a good spot there now, just to sit there and ride, take care of his car. I have a feeling that's what he's doing. He's running good, but he's not pushing it that much, and that's certainly not taking anything away from Rusty Wallace. He has a great car here today. We knew that he was going to be good, but it looks like that maybe Gordon is biding his time right now. How about it, Jerry?
Well, Ned, you're exactly right. And remember, lap 204, when he pitted, he only took on right side tires. Those left side tires have been on since lap 141, over 110 laps already. So that's one of the reasons he's trying to be very, very careful with the left side.
Jeff Burton is about to take second from Jeff Gordon. He does. Burton second, Gordon now third. Jeff has led two different times in this race for a total of 21 laps. Bobby Hamilton is still at the top of the list of those seven drivers who have led here this afternoon. Hamilton led 65 laps early on.
There's our fourth place car, Dale Earnhardt. And fifth is Ricky Craven. This is Hut Strickland's car, the Circuit City car we're riding along with. Hut ran so well early on in the race and had something go wrong in the pits, got him a lap down.
Let's take a look at our Busch race recap. Rusty is the current leader. He's led 45 laps so far. We've had 10 lead changes, 6 caution periods, total of 38, and the average speed is just slightly over 75 miles an hour. Those who have led a lap include Bobby Hamilton with the most, Jeff Burton second on that list, and we have had a couple of other drivers lead at least a lap, including Michael Waltrip. Now, let's take a look at those drivers who are off the track making repairs. They include Marlin and Robert Presley. And the list now of those drivers who are officially out of the race, just 3.
Grissom and Park both had engine problems.
Trickle was involved in 2 different wrecks.
There's Dale Jarrett running in 7th position. The 37 car is Jeremy Mayfield, and he is a lap down in 26th. And right behind him is Jeff Green, and he is also a lap down. So that is a battle for 26th position between Green and Mayfield. Then behind those two cars, there's Mark Martin, 105 points behind the championship going into this race. He's in 8th position. And we see Jeff Green taking the spot away from Jeremy. Oh, and Mayfield makes contact with Green and spins him around, and the caution comes out again.
Caution flag.
Jeff gets it running, so he's just not going to lose another lap.
Nope, he was already one down, but he's going to stay in that lap as Gordon, as Rusty comes around and gets the yellow flag.
As we watch all this, Kenny Irwin brought his car to pit road, and they decided now to take that car behind pit wall. They saw something, and here's a replay. Jeremy Mayfield, the 37 car, goes in the corner. Looks like he tries to drive under the 29 as the 29 drifts up, and boy, he just drove right in the left rear, and around goes Jeff. And I thought he was going to make it, Ned, but right there, he just barely touched the wall.
Yep, they should be able to pull the fenders out and get him back out there again.
Well, the question is this Rusty Wallace? Yes, it is. Bill Weber.
And they have decided to pit. 263 laps on the board. The 2, 99, and 24. Triple pitch on your screen. Rusty is here first. Burton is 2 stalls behind him. Gordon at the end of pit road. Right side for Wallace. Right side for the 99. Jerry Punch.
Right side's going on Jeff Gordon's car down. Left side tire is going on. Gordon pitting further up pit road. And the 2 and the 99. We'll see who's going to win the race. Burton is down, Rusty is down, and Gordon
comes off the jack, and now it's a scramble back to turn one. Close time pit stop, 18-2, 18-1, and 19 seconds.
And Dale Jarrett beat them all out. Change two tires. Now we go back to the back stretch and see what's happening back there. And we can see how well Ricky Craven was running. All the guys on the fronts have made their pit stop as he exits. And he went in the pits running about fifth. He come out running about 25th.
Bobby Hamilton comes out. So does Ted Musgrave, Johnny Benson, and others. Let's take a look at this most recent incident from our onboard camera with Mark Martin.
He was right behind it as he came off of turn four, and he sees that contact made between Jeremy Mayfield and the car 37, the 29 car of Jeff Green. Here it is again. Mayfield down on the inside, trying to make a run, as Benny said, coming off of the corner, but clipped him and around he went.
So they line up for a restart and a few more laps. We're going to take a break in the meantime. 265 laps completed here in Martinsville. Beautiful overhead shot of Martinsville Speedway. 50 years of racing celebrated this weekend. The overhead shot courtesy of the Pennzoil Copter Cam. Boy, a lot has changed since that September date in 1947 when this was a dirt track. Clay Earls said that the people that would come here wouldn't see a bit of dirt or dust flying in the air, and he admits himself it looked like an atomic bomb went off about 15 laps into the race. But what a greatly manicured and beautiful facility this is in 1997.
Hey, Bob, you know what that is? See that? You know what that is?
No, what?
That's the shadow of our copter cam.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, there he is.
Hey, how about that? There's the big eye in the sky. Giving us a little wave. Hi, guys. George and Barry at the controls up there. You're doing a great job. However, we still are under caution, and so that gives us an opportunity to sneak in another commercial break before we go back to racing. Stay with us for more live NASCAR Winston Cup racing. Back to racing here at Martinsville. The leader of the race is the pole sitter, Ward Burton, in car 22. Running second is Brett Bodine. However, those two cars did not make pit stops. We talked about how Dale Jarrett picked up quite a few positions during his pit stop, but he was is now in third spot.
He only took on two tires.
Now the 7 of Jeff Bodine is two laps down in 32nd. Jeremy Mayfield is even ahead of Jeff Bodine. Jarrett runs in third position. Jeremy Mayfield, by the way, is at the tail end of the lead lap in 24th. There's Dale in third, about three quarters of a second behind the leader, Ward Burton.
Didn't correct myself. I said that the 25 car of Ricky Craven would come out about 20th. He actually came out about 13th on that restart, so it was not as bad as I made it out to be hitting on the back stretch.
Now Jarrett tries to take second position away from Brett Bodine, who has taken the colors of his sponsor early in the season off that car. And Bobby Labonte, meanwhile, sneaks below Jarrett.
Yeah, he sees an opportunity. Maybe these cars that are running out here, he has fresher tires than they do, that maybe I can get up there and get back on the lead lap.
Yeah, he is not in a battle for position here with Jarrett. Bobby is a lap down 26th.
Jarrett is racing with Ricky Rudd, the next car behind him. And Jimmy Spencer and Rusty Wallace.
All of those cars are on the lead lap. Spencer is fifth place, Rusty sixth.
In terms of the championship contenders, we've already told you that Jarrett is third. Jeff Gordon is running in the eighth position, and Mark Martin is 10th.
Well, Jimmy Spencer evidently got awfully loose off the second corner, which allowed Rusty to get alongside.
He did indeed, man. The back end kicked out on that Ford. Now Hut Strickland moves on the inside of it. Hut is still a lap down.
Bill Weber, meanwhile, has caught up to Kenny Irwin, who gave it a heck of a run, Bill.
Well, a disappointing finish, but you sure impressed us again today. You had a good run.
We're having fun. It just got into a little D on the back straightaway. Just trying to make laps. Us having a ball.
So what do you think of Martinsville? A lot of rubbing out there. I saw you and Rusty and a couple other guys getting into it.
It was fun. I mean, I really didn't know what to expect. Everybody actually races a lot cleaner than what I thought. This Hasbro action car run good to
lap. That's Kenny Irwin.
Well, he started second and finished eighth at Richmond. He started third here this morning, and he will finish somewhere around 35th or so, depending upon what happens the rest of the race. But, again, a very impressive performance while he was out there.
Just a moment ago, I talked about Jimmy Spencer getting loose off turn two, and he goes down a corner. This is in the middle of the corner. As he starts to come off the corner, I think he ran across the left, the curb with his left front tire, which almost spun himself out.
All right, here's a battle for position now. Rusty Wallace, Dale Jarrett, and Ricky Rudd, as Rusty has gone into third spot.
Well, he has a good race car here today.
A little bit of damage there on the right side of Dale Jarrett's car as we look back at it.
Now, he and Rudd both, I think, just took on, I know Jarrett just took on two tires. I think Ricky Rudd did too. Just simply pulled away from everybody. He's on the tail end of the lead lap. Got himself a good lead over Ward Burton, who is leading the race. Here comes Hutch Strickland. He's a lap down, but still going fast.
Jeff Burton trying to pass Jimmy Spencer. He's been all over that car the last couple of laps. Jeff Gordon is right behind Jeff Burton.
In the meantime, Rusty has passed Brett Bodine and has taken over second.
There's Jeff Gordon. And, whoa, Jeff had quite a run there, didn't he?
Boy, did he have a run off that corner. This is the Kmart onboard camera, right along with Jeff Burton. There we see him from the outside as DW tries to get on the inside of Jeff Gordon. Jeff Gordon moves over so Darrell can't do that. Jeff Burton looks at the 23 car. Up close and personal.
That's a great shot.
Dark. When it gets dark, we know we got trouble.
Got close, didn't
we? Jimmy is hanging right in there, isn't he, up on that top lane? Whoop! Contact there with Burton. And with Gordon.
Made everybody in the grandstand stand up.
Sure did.
And here comes Martin Martin. He's trying to get by, so Jimmy Spencer running up in about the sixth spot a moment ago, and he's now falling back to about 10th.
Yeah, I think he was either fourth or fifth when the green flag.
Up front, meanwhile, Rusty has reduced the interval between himself and Ward Burton to about a car length, and here is how it happened.
Track interval. We see it was 1.2 seconds, and in five laps, he shut, closed it down to 0.8 tenths of a second, and it's go down to 0-0 right now because it is dead even as Rusty comes off the corner and will take the lead.
On lap 200, at the end of 293 laps, Rusty gets the lead back again. Position continues behind him. Here is Mark Martin and Ernie Irvin trying to get by Ricky Rudd.
And I think that two-tire change is beginning to tell now on Ricky. Same thing for Dale Jarrett. They just took on two tires, each of them, and I think that it's beginning to tell.
Ernie now getting to the inside of Rusty and completing the pass very easily.
So Jeff Gordon will go by Dale Jarrett and take over the fifth spot. There it is.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Ernie Irvin will be looking for a position. So Dale Jarrett loses some spots here.
That's a nice spot.
Just over 203 laps to go here at Martinsville in the Haynes 500. It's Rusty Wallace leading Ward Burton, Brett Bodine, Jeff Burton, and Jeff Gordon. Back in just a moment. Stay with us. In command of the Haynes 500 with 304 laps completed is Rusty Wallace. Got about a 3-second lead on Ward Burton, and in the last 40 short track races, Rusty Wallace has won 35% of them, finished in the top two 58%, and in the top 10 90% of the time. He has also led more than 5,300 laps, and he is counting them up here this afternoon as our current leader.
Pretty impressive. Pretty impressive. Let's go underneath the two car. Let's what everything looks like. This is the back of the car. As we look at the drive shaft, this is the drive shaft, round and around. This is toward the, this is the transmission up in this area. The back is back here. You know how I know that? Because the drive shaft is going up and down in the back. See, there are the rear springs. There's the gear. This little pulley here pumps the fluid out of the back of the car, circulates through a small radiator up in the car. You see a brake hose over here that blows some air back on the rotor on the left rear of the car. And you can see just how weak the springs are to let the rear end go up and down that much.
They run anywhere from a 200 maybe to a 250, somewhere in that neighborhood, and that's the strength of the spring. When you compress it 1 inch, it takes 250 pounds of pressure to do that.
Dale Earnhardt is on the move, just taken fifth position away from Brett Bodine. There's Jeff Gordon, who's trying to take over third spot from Ward Burton. In second right now is Jeff Burton. There goes Jeff Gordon to third spot. Robert Presley coming back on the racetrack.
Gordon at the third spot. His closest pursuer in the Winston Cup point stand is Mark Martin, is back in eighth spot.
Jared is back to 11.
You know, the 21 car, owned by the Wood Brothers, driven by Michael Walter. There we see him. I got some good news and some bad news about the 21 car. The bad news first. Back in the 70s, this car, the Wood Brothers car, was sponsored by Purolator. You remember those days when they had so much success?
Yep.
Well, the guy who headed that program, Whit Collins, passed away Monday. So to Jerry and the girls, all of us at ESPN are... hate to hear that. Really hated to hear that. We're so sorry. Now, the good news on the back of that car, it says, happy retirement, Larry and Fran. Larry Britton, who heads up the Citgo program, was here from day one, is retiring Tuesday. Will be his last day at Citgo. So, Larry and Fran, happy retirement.
And, Benny, there was even happier news this morning or last night when Buffy gave birth to a baby girl. And Michael was there.
He was there, helped do the deal, and he was excited about it this morning.
He had tears in his eyes, and he almost put tears in my eyes talking about it. He was very excited and very happy. Right now, however, as far as the race is concerned, he's in 29th position, a lap down. Here comes Rusty.
Well, he finally caught up to Jeremy Mayfield. Jeremy had a big lead on the leader when Ward Burton was leading the race, but now he's going to go a lap down. He's in 24th position.
Here is Dale Earnhardt trying to take fourth position away from Ward Burton. And he does.
Earnhardt's pretty good. I'm not sure that he's as good as Rusty Wallace and maybe Jeff Gordon, but his car is pretty doggone good. And I tell you what, he might be, Earnhardt just might be driving a really smart race today. He just might be waiting the last 100 laps.
Bill Weber has more on Rusty Wallace.
And
Rusty Wallace has been happy with that car since they got here on Friday. Robin Pemberton told me that this Penske team has better and newer cars at the shop, but they bring this older car here because it runs so well here. In fact, it has won here twice. Now, Rusty's car was so good on Saturday, they spent a lot of time on shocks. Normally, they run Penske shocks, but today, he's running Bilski shocks. It actually makes the ride of the car worse, but it makes the speed of the car better. He said the Bilski shocks were more gripping on this racetrack. This is a very rough racetrack. A lot to like driving over a railroad crossing in your passenger car time after time after time. So the fact they qualified so good and the fact their car has run so well since they got here enabled them to experiment and put Rusty on the leaderboard 318 laps into this thing.
Awesome spin, a spin.
Well, we've seen these two get together earlier in the day, and they have found each other again, Jeff Green and Jeremy Mayfield. Mayfield tries to pull away and almost came in contact with some cars.
I want you to remember that. I want you to remember that real good. Show my ass right here after this race. They can throw me out of NASCAR if they want.
There's some temper and some frustration showing here this afternoon, not unlike a Martinsville race.
Exactly. That's what I was hard to say. That's very normal here at the Martinsville Speedway.
And it's very normal for Rusty Wallace to be leading in Martinsville, isn't it?
As a matter of fact, it is. You know, Jeff Gordon is trying to become sweeping the both races in a year. We'll talk more about that in just a moment.
Never seen him going down in third corner. And 29 car Jeff Green just lays up on the left rear corner of Jeremy Mayfield and around he goes.
Jeff Gordon is trying to sweep both races in 1997. The last driver to win both races here at Martinsville was in 94. Rusty did it. Bill Weber.
Rusty Wallace, the leader of the race, leads the field down pit road. The 99, the 24 also on pit road. You can see them. 321 laps on the board now. You could probably go the distance from here if you had to. It'd be very, very close. This should be four tires for Rusty. They're around to the left side. Here's Jerry.
And bottoming his green, Jeff Gordon's crew. They're going to pull the front fenders out. They've already changed right side tires. They go to the left side of the car. Rusty topping his green. He is down and away. Jeff Gordon is down and away. And here goes Gordon. 19, 19, 2, 18, 7. These pit stops are just that close.
Big scramble coming out of the front stretch pit. Meanwhile, the activity picking up in the back stretch pit is Ernie Irvin. Gets some left side tires. The leaders flash by on the racetrack.
MC Ted Musgrave. In and out, Ernie Irvin.
Once again, we take a look at this most recent incident. This from the Pennzoil copter cam.
Going down the back stretch, going in turn three. Jeremy goes in the corner. You'll see the 29 car just right in the left rear and around goes the 37. But as you said, Bob, that's not the first time that those cars have made contact today.
So they're going to hold the 29 car for one lap because of that little incident. So Jeff Green will have to spend an extra one lap on pit road. Under caution, and we'll be back with more green flag racing in just a moment with 323 laps completed. ESPN Speed World coverage of NASCAR Winston Cup racing today at Martinsville Speedway in Virginia. We are just about to go back to racing. We thought we were going to this lap, but they've called it off. Well, Sunday, you can join Benny and me and Marty Reed out in Sears Point, Sonoma, California, as we have a big doubleheader for you at 4 o'clock Eastern Time. It's the NASCAR Winston West Fry's Electronic Omega Zip 100. And then at 6 o'clock, NASCAR Craftsman Trucks take to the track for the Kragen X-Side 151. Down to Bill Weber.
Rusty Wallace had a pit stop of 19.93 seconds on their clock. For those guys, that's slow, but one reason why: front tire changer Billy Wilburn had his sunglasses yanked back by his headset as he was going around to change the right front and then got hit below the right eye with a lug nut. He's okay. He said the dust bothered him more than anything, but he literally couldn't see the change to the tire. Green is out. Here we go.
Strickland is trying to get a lap back. He drives Jeff's in on the inside of Rusty Wallace. And Jeff Gordon is trying to get back to the inside so he can try to take the lead away.
Dave, Hunt Trickman has had a great race car all day. Don't know if it's as good as Rusty's or not, but right now he's going to get out in front of him. He's on the tail end of the lead lap.
He's in 24th position, and now at the tail end of the lead lap, it's Wallace, Gordon, Jeff Burton, Mark Martin, and Dale Earnhardt, the top five. As far as those in the back pit and where they went after the pit stops, well, Ernie Irvin went from 6th to 12th, and Brett Bodine from 8th to 15th.
That's one, two, three. Justin Wallace trying to get back right on the back bumper of Hutch Strickland. If he gets up and start beats on the rear bumper, I don't think Hutt will give him too hard a time, but if he can drive away, he will try his best right now to drive away from Rusty Wallace.
Well, he'd love to see a caution flag right now, Hutt Strickland would, so he could go all the way around the racetrack, and then when the next time he passed a lot of cars that he's already passed today, it would be fourth position.
Sterling Marlin has come back onto the racetrack. Here's another Napa field summary.
Ned, I think it's getting to the time that whatever you got, you better start showing it.
Yeah, if you've got anything left, you're right. We've saved those brakes and all of that, but down
169, right?
Okay.
I think my subtraction is correct.
You've made all your adjustments. You felt the chassis out. The racetrack is not going to change for the next hour or so. It's going to take to run these remaining laps, so it's time to go, if you have anything to go with.
They might be able to go the rest of the way as far as fuel is concerned. There were about 180 laps to go, or 175 laps to go when they made their pit stop. So, I don't know. They might be able to go the rest of the way.
Rusty Wallace, second in short track points going into this race, but he has had a very up and down year. Series leading 11 DNFs, more than all of his 95 and 96 total DNFs. Jerry, what's the deal regarding fuel?
Well, at least out here in the Jeff Gordon pit, he cannot make it. Based on the gear they're running, and Michael Landis has just calculated their fuel window, they'll have to pit at the latest at lap 478, so they'll be 22 laps shy of making it all the way.
Joe Vernachek, a little sideways.
Yeah, it was very sideways. They do burn a lot more fuel per mile on a short track because of the low gear that they pull in the rear end. They turn, as Benny has said before, they turn more RPMs here perhaps than anywhere else, and so that burns up some fuel.
And one reason to turn a lot of RPMs is they go down the straightaway. As you come off the corner, as you accelerate, when you get to the next corner, we've seen the brakes. When they back off the gas, they want the engine to try to help them slow that car down. Don't use too many brakes. Try to let the engine slow the car down.
Check the speeds at the line. See who's fastest out there.
Well, Rusty Wallace is faster than anybody I see on the clock.
I think you're right, Ned.
And the first three cars, the only three cars in the 91-mile-per-hour range.
They have no traffic to contend with, so they're faster than anybody else out there. Well, now we see Ernie Irvin, second quick.
Yeah, and we don't, you know, Hutch Strickland is not in that clocking there because he's a tail end of the lead lap, and he's running as fast as Rusty Wallace is.
Now we see Ernie Irvin, who was the fastest that time, but unfortunately he's running up on the back of the bottom of Monte car. We'll see. Yes, once again, was the fastest car.
And there he goes to the inside of Bobby Labonte.
Now this time will be slower for Ernie Irvin.
That is not for position. Labonte is a lap down. Ernie is in 10th.
Check this time we said Ernie's speed was 90.292 miles per hour. So he lost at least 1 mile per hour. And here we see Rusty Wallace. He has caught up Strickland. He's trying to get by.
Because Jeff Gordon is all over Rusty now. So Rusty's got to go. He can't let Hutt stay out there any longer.
Got to go ahead and put him a lap down. Sees that 24 coming up back there. Don't know how much he might have been saving, if any. So it's time to go.
Now Rusty has a 29 car, Jeff Green, ahead of him.
That was a class move by Husker. Once he got there, he just said, as bad as he wanted that lap back, he saw that the leaders had run him down, so obviously they were faster. He moved over, let them go. And he'll do the same thing for the 99 of Jeff Burton.
And we mentioned it earlier, but the Stavola team will switch from Ford to Chevy next year for Hutt. So there are your top three, Wallace, Gordon, and in third position, the number 99 car of Jeff Burton. 343 laps completed. We'll take a break and be back with more live coverage of the Haynes 500. Wednesday, ESPN's National Hockey Night begins another season as Eric Lindros and the Philadelphia Flyers look to turn last year's final demise into this year's Stanley Cup celebration. They begin their quest at home against the Florida Panthers. It's at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific time. Wednesday night, the Panthers and Flyers as the hockey season opens again. And Benny, I know you're as excited as I am about that.
Boy, I can't wait. Oh, yeah, we got a hockey team now. The Hurricanes.
Yeah.
In Greensboro, North Carolina.
Yep. Boy.
Wonder why they're called the Hurricanes. Because we get a lot of Hurricanes in North Carolina. First three cars, Rusty Wallace, Jeff Gordon, Jeff Burton.
Back here to 6th, 7th, and 8th position, we have Ward Burton, Bill Elliott, and Ernie Irvin.
Well, they just went by. There they are.
Ernie continues to march on up through the field. He passed Ricky Craven not too long ago and now has caught this duo, as now Bill Elliott will pass the Ward Burton car, and Ernie's going to try to follow him right through.
Bill Elliott has 7 top 10 finishes in the last 10 races.
This has to be one of Ernie Irvin's best racetracks on the circuit because he runs so well here. Wasn't here where he won his first race in the 28 car?
Yeah, in the 28 car. Right.
And after he took over for Davey Allison.
Since the restart, let's check Ernie Irvin's progress. He was 12th on lap 328 and now has moved to 7th spot.
On the track to say you can't pass him.
In this race last year, Ernie finished 12th, and he was 31st here in the spring. Joe Nemechek goes a lap down. Here's Bill Weber.
And Joe Nemechek had a great qualifying effort. He started this race from the 8th spot. That car he is driving is called Nightmare, and he's about to have another one because he is losing his brakes.
Yeah, it was obvious to see a moment ago. Commercial break. You go in the corner, let the car drift up the racetrack, kind of like the 99 car was there. That just signifies that he had to slow the car down. He had to let it roll in the corner and break to what keeps it from the bottom of the racetrack.
Jeff Green going behind the wall on the back stretch. Speaking of brakes,
check out Mark Martin's brakes. There you see Mark Martin. He gets down the corner behind. Oh, baby.
Oh, man.
Mark's in what, fourth place then?
Fourth place, and he's running harder now. As you suggested a while ago, if you got anything left, you got to do it now. And use those brakes a little bit harder, and, well, you can see it there.
He comes off the corner. That's why in all those hoses in the front of the car to blow air back on those rotors, cool them off. Because they know that's what's going to happen when they go in the corner.
Be awfully careful as to not get that bead or get that wheel so hot that it melts the bead, like Robert Presley had a little while ago.
Now let's check out the same position on Ricky Craven's car.
Wow. His brakes are just as cool as they can be.
Yeah.
This is probably the coolest I've ever seen brakes at Martinsville.
Mark's rotor is blowing all the way around the racetrack. Brightens up in the corners, of course. Yeah, his is in the corners.
And it's amazing to watch these front tires. You can tell when the car gets out of shape because you're going to corner, it just turns a little bit. If the back end jumps out, all of a sudden that wheel will turn viciously to the right as you tries to save. That time he made a smooth corner.
Craven is in ninth position. We have a battle for second.
Between the two Jeffs, Gordon and Burton, that is.
Burton putting the pressure on Jeff Gordon.
Rusty has increased his lead to over a second, about a second and a third now, 1.31 seconds.
You know, Jeff Burton's going to have a teammate sharing his shop next year, Bob.
Yeah, I hear that.
Mark Martin. The rumor, or I guess the facts are, they're going to move the sixth car from Liberty, North Carolina, over to Mooresville along in the 99 shop. And Johnny Benson will take the entire crew, with the exception of crew chief Jimmy Finney, for his new 26 car. That's what Bill Weber reported on RPM tonight, or NASA, or Sports Center, or one of those shows Weber does.
So they'll hire basically a new crew then for Mark Martin's car. That was a surprise here this weekend when that word got out.
22 cars on the lead lap. David Green, the final car on the lead lap. There goes Jeff Gordon around John Andretti. You'll see John's position show up here as we change to the next panel. There he is in 32nd. There is Mark Martin. And just about 8-tenths of a second behind Mark is Dale Earnhardt, who, of course, had a second-place finish at Dover last weekend, just his fourth top five of 92nd, but his second straight top 10. You mentioned it earlier, but Darrell Waltrip had problems at the very beginning of the program, very beginning of the race, and fell back. But since they got the problem corrected, he's hung in there.
Yeah, he's run with the leaders ever since then.
He's Mr. Martinsville because he is the winningest active driver with 11 victories, also has 27 top fives and 31 top tens, has led more than 3,600 laps. Back in just a moment.
He's up against the wall.
ESPN Speed World coverage continues at Martinsville Speedway in Virginia, the Haynes 500, being brought to you by Team Monte Carlo, Chevy, the car's more champions trust, by Firestone, America's tire since 1900, and by Splitfire. Enter the performance zone with Splitfire Performance V spark plugs. Well, we've had another caution, and we've had another round of pit stops.
And the caution was when Jeff Bodine spun up in turn four. I don't think he made contact with the wall, but anyway, the caution flag was thrown, and all the cars there is Jeff Bodine at QVC4. By the way, he's looking for a new sponsor in 1998. QVC announced they would not be coming back.
Now, as a result of the pit stops, here's how everybody is running. It's Rusty Wallace leading, Jeff Burton second, Jeff Gordon third, then Ricky Rudd, Mark Martin, Bill Elliott, Dale Earnhardt, Bobby Hamilton, Ward Burton, and Rick Mast.
Uh-oh, piece of debris there on the racetrack. NASCAR officials is running across the track as we speak to pick it up. Oh, wait a minute. That's a different piece of debris.
There's a couple of pieces of debris out there.
Oh, there's all kinds of NASCAR officials.
While they clean up the debris from the racetrack, we'll sneak in another quick commercial break. Be back in a moment to Martinsville. Stay with us. You watch the restart from the Pennzoil copter cam overhead. The aerial view showing that Rusty Wallace with about a car length advantage on Jeff Burton.
And you see Mark Martin trying to go by Ricky Rudd on the outside, and looks like he'll make it work, so put him into the fourth spot.
I think Rudd only took on two tires. He gained a lot of positions on that pit stop. Realizes that Mark probably has a little bit better car with four new tires on it.
Championship contenders, Jeff Gordon is third, Mark Martin is fourth, and Dale Jarrett is 15th.
And he just lost a couple of positions. He got bumped coming off of turn four and almost spun out and didn't get it back in, but losing positions.
From Mark Martin's car, he looks back at Ricky Rudd.
Mm-hmm. points were awarded right now, Jeff Gordon would pick up just 5. The interval would be 110, and Dale Earnhardt would move from 6th position up into the top 5. Now 6 through 10, Labonte would of course lose one. Bobby Labonte and Elliott would stay the same. Rudd would move up ahead of Musgrave in that tight battle for 9th position in the point standings. All of this, of course, will come to a climax, and the checks will be handed out at the Waldorf Astoria, and as per usual, ESPN will be there.
Dale Jarrett that time gets a little loose off the corner, and some contact between him and Skinner. He drives it out of there. That's a battle for position between the 88 and 31. And the 25 and 30, I guess all that's for position. Nope. Yes, it is. All those cars battling for position. 16, throw him in the mix as well. And 11. 31 struggled to get a lap back. He made it, and now goes by the 88 to take that spot away.
Oh, contact there between Craven and Benson.
And Ricky Craven trying to save the car, lost 2 spots. And Benson tries to look on the inside of Jarrett.
We haven't talked much about Ted Musgrave here today, but he is in 19th position, still running on the lead lap.
There's still 22 cars on the lead lap.
Family Channel will not be back on his car in 1998, but we understand that Primestar will continue to sponsor that Jack Roush-owned car.
As he takes a look on the inside of Benson, can't quite make it. Johnny Benson will be his teammate in 1998.
1995 in the spring race, Ted Musgrave finished 2nd here. It's been his best finish. He was 20th a year ago in this race and 24th here in the spring.
Jeff Bodine in the 7 car is 4 laps down in 31st position, letting those cars go by on the outside that are in the lead lap. Musgrave in the 16 car, as Bob said, is in 19th position. Made a late pit stop on this last caution, came back in another time and was at the tail end. I mean, he was the last car on the grid lap, so he still picked up a few positions.
Also haven't talked much about Brett Bodine here today, but he stays on the lead lap and has got a good run, a top 20 run going. Earnhardt and Bobby Hamilton are 7th and 8th.
Hamilton was running in the, I think it was like the 15th or 16th position before that pit stop. So apparently he just took on 2 tires. So he's back up there. Hadn't seen him for a while. You know, he led the race there early and was really good. Then got a little bit off sequence as far as pit stops were concerned. Pitting on the back got him behind too. And now beginning to flex his muscles again. He said, we're going to do it. It's time now.
For 5th spot between Ricky Rudd and Bill Elliott.
Bill Weber has more on Bill Elliott.
This has turned out to be a pretty good day so far for Bill Elliott, a car that wasn't very good in final practice. But crew chief Mike Mead made a right front shock change and a track bar adjusted to tighten up the car. During this previous pit stop, they talked about taking just 2 tires, but Bill vetoed that. He said, you're going to have 4 because that's what it's going to take to run to the finish. This car should get better the more laps in. Beam had originally said 30 laps. That car was really hooked up. It's the last race for Mack tonight on Bill Elliott's car, and they've also got a very strange sticker on that car, one that celebrates the 50th anniversary of the CIA. When I asked what that was about, they said they were trying to get some information on the new Ford Taurus.
And if the information went beyond that sticker, they would have to shoot you, right?
Yes.
Bill Elliott has only 1 short track top 10 this season. That was at the spring race in Bristol when he finished 7th. Now Dale Earnhardt and Ricky Rudd are battling for 6th.
Earnhardt drives on the down in the corner and takes it away.
A among those in the top seven right now. Everyone has won a short track race with the exception of Jeff Burton, who is running in second spot to Rusty Wallace. Just a little over 100 laps here to go in the Haynes 500. Rain delayed from yesterday, but it's a beautiful Monday here in Martinsville. Thursday, start your college football weekend off with the weekend kickoff show presented by Coors Light. Then stay tuned for a WAC battle between the Utah Utes and the Fresno State Bulldogs. All the action on ESPN, your home for college football. That was a nice catch that that guy made, wasn't it?
Tell you what, it sure was.
Okay, back to the action at hand here. It's Rusty Wallace with about a third of a second lead on Jeff Burton. Jeff Gordon third, Martin is fourth, and Bill Elliott in fifth position. There's the interval between first and second.
Not much. But right now, Mark Martin is really being pressed by Bill Elliott and Dale Earnhardt. As a matter of fact, Earnhardt's on the outside of Elliott, trying to go by. Elliott drives down to the inside, but Earnhardt's going on the outside.
And the crowd comes to its feet here in the main grandstand, cheering Dale Earnhardt past Bill Elliott.
Two of the biggest names in stock car racing in the 80s, Bill Elliott and Dale Earnhardt, but Earnhardt disposes of Elliott. Now will go by Mark Martin on the outside, and Elliott will as well. 10 valuable points going down right there by Mark Martin.
That is exactly right. You wouldn't think that would be very much, but it was 10 points, and that could be the difference between winning and losing the championship and $1.5 million.
But Mark knew that they came up on him in a hurry, and he wasn't going to fight them. As the leader, Rusty Wallace, is in big traffic, so Mark he didn't fight him too much. They came up on me, they're running faster than I am, so, you know, I'm still point racing. Here you can see Rusty coming up on the 29 car of Jeff Green.
Earnhardt has been the fastest car on the racetrack among the top six in the last couple of laps.
Jeff Burton is looking on the outside, took that wide angle, and they're hoping to get the two car hung up behind the 98. Did not work. He was hoping that he could use the 98. John Andretti has a pick. This time he'll try it on the inside.
Jeff Burton, of course, has been ill with an inner ear infection and had some relief earlier in the year. However, during the last two races, while he has been struggling with this problem, he has actually increased his lead on fifth position by 159 points.
And Terry Labonte is the guy in fifth place, and Terry right now is running a lap down in 25th position, so Burton stands a good chance to increase that even more.
Yeah, that statistic probably indicates more of a struggle that Terry Labonte has been having than good fortune that Jeff Burton has been having.
In the interviews that Jeff Burton has done down with Jerry Punch, Bill Weber, and John Kernan over the weekend, he says that he feels fine in the race car, just when he lays down, that he doesn't feel that good. He said, of course, not feel good in the race car.
And Jerry has more on Jeff.
Well, exactly, Benny. What he told us was it's an inner ear problem. He had a viral infection of the inner ear, which is what controls your equilibrium. And if he lays completely down or looks down toward his feet, he gets dizzy. He gets has problems with standing still, equilibrium. As long as he sits still in the race car and looks straight ahead, he is fine. So as he told us, Benny, he feels exactly the best when he's in the car.
Well, he certainly must feel good this afternoon because he's had an excellent, excellent race. Just that far out of the lead.
Remember, he was leading the race back earlier, and he built up a pretty good lead at one time. And then I think Buddy Parrott, the crew chief, said, hey, back off a little bit. Don't need to be running that fast this early in the race. You got to take care of those brakes. And he backed off and even gave up the lead. And I think that was a smart move at that time.
We have had seven different leaders. Rusty Wallace has led the most, 167.
91 laps to go. And Dale Earnhardt, our fourth place car. Take a look at this AutoZone on-track interval. In five laps, he closed it from 6.8 seconds behind the leader to 5.6. 1.2 seconds gain in just five laps by Earnhardt. He is on the move. He also has a long way to go, but.
Yeah, he's a little over 5 seconds behind. You see there, about 5 and a half.
Chad Little is the 97 car who was involved in an incident earlier in the race. So here's the battle for the lead now again as Jeff again looks to the outside of Rusty.
Jeff Burton came up here testing, and they came here for one reason, for Jeff Burton to learn how to run 500 laps and have breaks at the end. They ran 500 laps, and he wanted one thing, to have breaks at the end of 500 laps.
Just 88 laps to go, and the Haynes 500 will be history. The brakes are glowing on most of these cars. There's Mark Martin's brake rotor glowing cherry red with less than 100 laps to go here in Martinsville. Be right back. It remains very close for first and second between Rusty Wallace and Jeff Burton, and Jeff Gordon has also closed in to make it a three-vehicle race.
Just a little over 1 second separating Rusty Wallace from Jeff Gordon.
And in the meantime, Dale Earnhardt continues to chop that lead down a little bit more.
These are the intervals now. And you will also see the fastest laps represented by the yellow arrows.
See, the Rusty Wallace that time did run the fastest lap.
Second fastest was Jeff Gordon, and he was 1.15 seconds behind the leader.
And that time, Jeff Burton was the fastest.
Earnhardt second.
He picked up a little bit. He picked up about 0.2 seconds on Rusty Wallace that time.
Rusty's crew is saying that he isn't complaining about anything, but I don't think the car is running as well as it was earlier.
His lap times are not as good as they were earlier, but the track has to be a little bit slicker now than it was earlier.
Earnhardt's got, as he tries to run down the two car, he has four or five lap cars between he and Rusty Wallace right now. So that is going to, there, see all those cars coming. David Green, Bobby Labonte, Michael Walker, all those cars.
And that's one of the reasons that he was able to close that gap some is because Rusty and Jeff Burton and Jeff Gordon had to go through all that.
Sides tell you had the fastest lap that time, and twice in a row Jeff Gordon had the fastest lap. Elliott that time had the second fastest lap.
No, Ernie Irvin had the second fastest lap.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, Ernie is coming on back up through. Boy, that back stretch pits is really hurting him today. He was 12th when he came out of the pits. He's now worked his way back up to 8th.
A little over 4 seconds when he started doing this, and as he works his way through the traffic, he's now up to almost 5 seconds behind, so he's lost almost one full second on the leader trying to work his way through the traffic.
4 laps to go. Now Earnhardt with a clear racetrack in front of him. Rusty Wallace in some traffic as he tries to get to the inside of Ted Musgrave going into turn one.
That time Earnhardt in that clear traffic did have the fastest lap. So there's no doubt that Dale Earnhardt is as close today to the competition as about any racetrack he's been this year.
Let's update you on the points situation. Jeff Gordon is in third, Mark Martin is seventh, and Dale Jarrett is 16th.
And twice in a row, Dale Earnhardt has the fastest lap.
Once he cleared that traffic, he could go. Jimmy Spencer has a problem with the backstretch. He was running in 12th position, apparently has a flat tire. Slow up on the outside of the racetrack. I don't know if he's going to be able to get back in or not. He can't get back down in line. This is the biggest problem. Cars keep coming. He's up on the high side of the racetrack.
And there literally is cars all around the racetrack as he tries his best.
There he has an opening.
Yeah, good job, Jimmy.
Wow.
Well, he's in the first pits. I thought he started to go behind the wall. Apparently his brakes are, well, not completely, because he did get stopped there, but the crew going under the hood.
And then it looks like that he did all that without any power. They're acting like he has no power. And the guy inside the car looks to be changing ignition boxes or something. Wow.
Mark Martin, meanwhile, is also in a bit of a struggle out there. He's dropped back to eighth spot.
Ernie Irvin moved around him.
Riding on board with Mark.
We watch Mark as he goes out in turn one. He turns the car. He's not going back to the right too much, so it tells you he might be pushing a little bit.
And, Benny, I wonder, you know, last time we looked at his brakes, he was really on those things hard. He was running in fourth place at the time, and you wonder if he might have used them up, thinking he had enough to go to the end of the race, and maybe now found out maybe they aren't going to last that long and have to back off with it. Here comes Ricky Rudd coming up on him now. It was ringy, ringy red when we looked at it before. It's still red, and he's still ringy, ringy red, too, so I don't know. And that could be his reason for slowing down is that those brakes are so hot.
Folks, on this shock absorber, this is a shock absorber there. On the shock, that little rubber piece there, that indicates to the teams how much travel there is on that shock, how strong their spring is or how weak it is, how much it's allowing that wheel to go up and down. That's one of the adjustments. When they look at that, Garrett Marshall, let me want 2.5 inches. If it's 3, they realize they've got too soft a spring, they put a stronger spring in.
Meanwhile, Jimmy Spencer has gone behind the wall. Whatever his problem was, they were not able to fix it out on pit road, so they pushed him behind the wall.
And Jeff Burton now gets a fender into the inside of Rusty Wallace. This is the battle for the lead. Let's see. Rusty holds him up for the moment.
Jeff Burton saw the slower cars up in front. He did not want to be caught down on the inside with the slower cars. So he wisely backed off as we've now got two cars, Retro 9, Joe Nemechek, side by side. Which one of the slow cars do you go with?
Brett Bodine is on the lead lap.
Whoa, look at
him. At least for the moment, Brett is running into 18th position.
Well, Rusty gallantly holding off Jeff Burton. We've only got 62 more laps to go. Can Rusty continue to hold off the challenge of Jeff Burton and Jeff Gordon? Back in a moment. The question that I asked going to break, can Rusty Wallace hold off the challenge of Jeff Burton? The answer is no. Jeff Burton has gone into the lead, and all of this courtesy of the Pennzoil Copter Cam. Brett Bodine goes a lap down, and this is how Jeff got the lead from Rusty.
The hard way on the outside. Going down in turn one. Coming off turn two, they're absolutely side by side, but Burt gets a great grip off the corner, accelerates, and Rusty says, hey, he's got the spot. Might as well let him go ahead and take it.
Well, Jeff Burton did finish second at Richmond. That's his best short track finish of the year. And he's looking at a possible victory here this afternoon. Bill Weber, meanwhile, has caught up with Jimmy Spencer.
And a lot of heartbreaking moments this season. Jimmy, what's the problem with your car?
Some broken a driveline, Bill. You're right. It's been a heartbreaking season for us. We've had top 10 cars so many times. There's not enough time to really fix the car and benefit from it or go any of the guys that do it. There's no question. I feel bad for my guys because they work so darn hard, and we just don't have no luck, but that's part of this sport. We'll just get some better luck next time.
Well, we have a crash in turn four. Michael Waltrip was the first to hit the wall. He had no steering. A car came down the track and hit Mike Skinner.
And Skinner had a great run going. He was about 15th to 16th spot on the lead lap. But Michael Walton's car, the wall did the damage to the right side, and
Yeah, Skinner was up to about 12th. We saw Mark Martin really struggling. Now, the group of cars had really bunched up there with Mark Martin. And let's go to the pits and find out why with Jerry Punch.
I just asked Steve Meehl, was it brakes? He said, no. I know the brakes look hot on camera, Doc. He said, but it's not the brakes. We got plenty of brakes. And believe it or not, the car is so loose, he has to be very careful getting in the corner. He's driving about a half a lane up higher on the racetrack than he'd like to drive. He just can't drive the car in the turns because it'll break loose. This caution flag will help him a lot.
Well, indeed, the caution will allow some adjustments to be made.
Looks like that left front tire is about flat, but I guess it's not.
They run them awfully. The air pressure very low on the short track, that left front in particular. Now here comes Michael Walker getting out of the Citgo Ford.
Glad to see that he is okay. Let's take a look at the incident up in turn four.
Never see Mark Martin and never see the 21 car coming down off the wall, as you said. No place, nothing he could do, and just bam, right in the side of the 31 car.
From the Pennzoil copter cam.
Now we see Skinner, the 31 car.
On the inside of Mark Martin. But there comes Michael Waltrip, bam, down across the racetrack, hit Skinner. He didn't even know he was coming.
What'd you say at the very top of the show when Jeff Gordon did that 2 years ago with Sterling Marlin? Trouble just jumps out and finds you. Now see Michael Waltrip, bam, looks like the right front tire went down. And he went in the corner up and hit the wall right in the middle of the corner, and then bam, comes across, and there he gets Skinner.
That wasn't a matter of Michael just trying to get to the pits. He had no control over the car whatsoever when he slid into Skinner.
Exactly right.
Right now, the pits are closed because the accident is so close to pit entrance, and so for the moment, the cars stay out there on the racetrack while Michael Waltrip walks back to his pit. Back in a moment. Well, you really haven't missed anything. The pits still are not open. They're cleaning up the crash down at the exit of turn number four, right at the entrance to pit road. You can find out all kinds of information, not only about NASCAR Winston Cup, but any division in NASCAR, by the www.nascar.com website. That's the word I'm trying to think of. All the information you'd ever want to know about drivers or statistics or whatever, www.nascar.com. Now the pits are open, and we'll see a lot of action. Bill Weber, they're headed toward you.
454 laps on the board, and Jeff Burton leads Rusty Wallace down pit road, 4,500 RPMs. And the Exide crew will go to work. A slight air pressure adjustment. They expect to take four tires. Jerry Punch.
Expect possibly just a two-tire change on a 24 car. A lot of them are going to get four. They're going to go four on a 24. Back to you, Bill.
And it is four also for Burton. They've got the left sides tight. Burton is on his way. He's going to race Rusty Wallace down toward Jeff Gordon. Wallace beats the 99.
And Dale Earnhardt will beat Jeff Gordon out of the pits. Check those out.
Ooh. Meanwhile, Hamilton is pitted over on the backstretch, and he completes his work and goes onto the acceleration lane.
And I tell you what, Bobby Hamilton's going to be in pretty good shape here.
And when I said, ooh, it was one of Mark Martin's crew that rolled across on pit road. He was he was okay. He got up and walked away. But
there's also some concern in Kenny Wallace's pit area.
Here's what we're talking about. As they come out of the pits, look in the middle of the screen. Here's Mark Martin coming out, and there's one of his crew members.
Yeah, wow.
Now, it looked like he might have been trying to get the wedge bolt out of the car, maybe. I'm not sure. He was back in now, so.
So all this means that the standings will scramble once again because of the pit stops. Earnhardt will move up a position. Before we go green, another break from Martinsville. Back at Martinsville, where we remain under caution with now just a little over 40 laps to go. This is what happened on pit road just a few minutes ago.
Watching Mark Martin's car, this is the car here, as the pit stop progresses. We see Mark kind of working on the right side as he starts to leave, and he catches, he's got an air hose or something that tripped this guy. The air hose off this guy here, the air hose tripped this guy or something. Jerry Punch, you know what happened?
Apparently, Jerry's mic is not working. We'll check on what happened in the Mark Martin pit and in the Kenny Wallace pit, because there was also an injury down in Kenny's pit box. In any case, they're getting lined up for the restart. I think they're going to get the one more to go signal this time. No, I guess they won't.
Now, from the Pennzoil copter cam, let's show you the pit stops. There's the front pit. Here, this is the front pit. Now, the pace car that will pick up, there's no one on the back pit, so the pace car will speed up and will bring the cars pitting on the backstretch around. And I suppose that Bobby Hamilton was the first car on the backstretch pits will be Bobby Hamilton. He dives to the inside, and here he is coming down pit road, slowly comes down up here to the pit road speed. The guys on the front pit still changing tires. They're starting to leave now. Hamilton stops. There, he stops. They go around to the car. Meanwhile, the leaders are coming off pit road. They change the right sides on Hamilton's car. And two tires. He goes back out as the leaders go by.
They put Bobby back in fourth position, so he falls in between Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon. Bill Weber.
Well, Michael, Waltrip's day had a great beginning, but a rough ending here on the track. What happened out there, Mike?
I lost the brakes. No warning. Went into three and just straight to the floorboard. I was trying to grab third and hang on, do anything to slow it down, and it just wasn't to be. We lost the power steering on the first lap. I ran all day long without any. We were just trying to hang on and salvage what we could, and it didn't happen, but nothing could mess this day up. It's the best day of my life. And, you know, this is just a minor setback. We'll go to Charlotte with a beautiful 1970s rendition of the Sit Go Ford Thunderbird. We're real excited about that car color scheme down there. I want to say hello to Mr. Britton and Fran. They're retiring this week. Nobody will be missed in this sport more than those two will. We love them. Hi, Buffy. I'll be home in a little bit. Thank you for your time.
Show them your bracelet. Show them. You have to have a pass to get in the pit, so he's got to have his pass to get back in the hospital to see his new baby girl and his wife.
Glad to hear everything's okay, Michael. Now down to Jerry.
All right, we're with Stan Blaylock, who's the catch can man for Kenny Wallace's team. And Stan, what happened out there? First of all, you're okay, right?
Yeah, I'm fine.
The knee's a little bit sore, but what happened?
I think a hose got pulled or something, got up under my knee and just dragged me to the ground.
So one of the cars coming out of the pits behind you may have grabbed the hose and the air wrench and that. Anyway, you got flipped in the air, right?
Yeah, I could hear the hose snaking around with the air coming out of it, so.
All right, Stan Blaylock, okay. Got a little bit of a bruise. They're going to put some ice on his left knee, but he wants everybody at home to know he is okay. So apparently the air gun that was attached to the hose is somewhere on the backstretch. They pulled it off the track, though.
Green flag. Here we go.
Earnhardt got a tough break as he tries to go by David Green. He's losing four or five car lengths to the leaders.
The spotter's telling David Green, hey, slow down. Give him a break. Let him go. He's got making up to do. David gets in plenty of room. Gets on by him, and Bobby Hamilton gets by as well. Darrell Waltrip is still two laps down in the 17 car going by David Green.
Bobby Hamilton, that STP Pontiac, took a lot of strength earlier on.
He sure did. He led 65 laps on two different occasions. Another strong run by Bobby Hamilton. And told you earlier that he had his best finish of 1997 in the spring race here at this track.
And look at him. He's trying to pass Dale Earnhardt going into turn three. Earnhardt gives him the room. But he couldn't make the pass. He was pinched off down there. Here comes Gordon. Looks like Earnhardt's car maybe is pushing up a little bit in the turns, Benny, more than it was there earlier. Ooh, Bobby Hamilton almost ran.
Oh, there's
some oil. There's some oil. Ernie Irvin's into the wall. There is definitely oil there. Several cars sliding high.
Terry Labonte is sideways in the racetrack, in addition to Ernie Irvin, who is now getting his Texaco Haviland Ford headed in the right direction. And another caution waves.
So Earnhardt, we saw Earnhardt go in the corner and hit that oil or fluid, whatever fluid was in the racetrack, and slide up the hill.
That's why his car wouldn't stay down on the turn.
But meanwhile, Bobby Hamilton does have that position. We see the third place vehicle, the STP Pontiac of Hamilton. See the left, the damage to the left rear, back where the gasoline goes in, but fortunately for Ernie, you don't have to put any more gasoline in.
No, he's got enough to go the rest of the way, if it didn't mess up something else.
Back down to Jerry Punch.
Well, a moment ago on the Mark Martin pit stop, the guy you were looking at was Luke Schimpf. He was the rear tire carrier, and he was actually trying to put wedge in the car. Remember, we told you how loose Mark Martin's car and how bad it was handling prior to that caution flag? Well, Luke was trying to put wedge in the car, and as the car took off, he couldn't get the wedge handle out, so I sort of drug him down pit road. There you see him tumble. He is okay. Tell everyone home he's fine, but he was trying to grab that wedge handle and pull it out of the right rear window.
Did you see him walking, running around saying, I got it in, or I didn't get it in? What he was trying to tell the crew chief was either I did get the wedge in or I didn't get it in, but he was anxious to tell his story.
Well, the track crew is out putting some oil dry on the racetrack here on the front straightaway. From Hunt Strickland's onboard camera early in the race.
We're in this wreck.
The wreck.
Ernie just goes in, and you see the back end just break loose, and away he goes. So there must be some pretty serious oil there.
So the track crew is going to work. Meanwhile, just a few more laps remain in this 500 lapper at Martinsville. Back in just a moment. Just 28 laps to go in the Haynes 500 at Martinsville at 7:30 Eastern Time tonight here on ESPN. Tuned into NFL Prime Monday as host Mike Tirico and his team tackle all the big stories from yesterday's matchups and give you an in-depth preview of the Monday night football game over on ABC. It's the San Francisco 49ers and the Carolina Panthers live at 9 o'clock tonight on ABC's Monday Night Football.
Sure glad you straightened it up. I couldn't figure out if it's 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock. 9 o'clock,
9
huh?
o'clock Eastern, yes. But you can tune in at 8 and catch all the previews.
Yep. Live from Erickson Stadium, downtown Charlotte, North Carolina. Boy, this might be what the doctor ordered for Rusty Wallace because, Ned, we talked about on the break, Jeff Burton seemed to be a little bit stronger on the long runs.
Yeah, before this one came out, he was pulling away from Rusty and had enough fuel to go the rest of the way. I think that he really hated to see either of those cautions come out.
Caution still out. We'll sneak in another quick break here. Come back to us in just a few minutes for more from Martinsville.
Welcome back to Martinsville.
She took the words right out of my mouth. We thought we were going to go green, but we're not. They are keeping the caution out for at least one more lap. What we have here is Rusty Wallace in the lead with Jeff Burton, Bobby Hamilton, Dale Earnhardt, and Jeff Gordon, your top five. Speedy dry just about all the way around this racetrack.
And particularly in turns 3 and 4, and so now that the cars have doubled up, they're letting them run through that a lap or two to try to get it worked in and blown off.
Jerry Punch.
Well, that's why they gave the field the one to go last time by. They knew that the guys wouldn't run through the speedy dry unless they had the one to go signal. They had to double up anyway and get ready for the green flag. So they gave them one to go. They all got side by side, ran through the speedy dry, sort of so it would disperse it across the track. Then they called off the start. Let's go to Bill Weber.
And this is Robin Pemberton, Rusty's crew chief. First of all, how does the track look?
It's a little dirty right now. We're trying to get them to blow it off, and I guess instead of doing that, they're going to try to run the cars too wide for a couple of laps. We can just hope for the best. We've got everything to lose and nothing to gain right now. So,
18.46 on your last stop, Robin. Obviously, Rusty giving up the lead. You gave it back to him.
Yeah, the guys have done a great job today.
Yeah, and he got one to go. Jerry.
I just asked Larry McReynolds if Dale Earnhardt had anything for the top three. He said, Doc, you know something? Our car is great after 30 laps. From 30 laps on, we're the fastest thing on the racetrack. The real problem is there's only 24 to go.
But they will go green next time around. There is Dale Earnhardt running in fourth position. Well, Jeff Burton certainly has turned his year around in terms of short track performances. At Richmond, he was 42nd, the same at Bristol, 15th at Martinsville, but look at the most recent two. Fourth at Bristol, second at Richmond, and he's second here with 24 laps to go.
Start. Be ready. Get ready.
Yeah, be ready.
Go. Green flag.
Well, Rusty didn't hardly let the pace car get off the racetrack. He wanted to go.
Well, he wiggled now going into one. I don't know whether that was intentional or not, but.
Oh, and the eight car almost spun. Hustricker almost spun coming off the corner. A lot of oil dry out there.
And that's why all these cars are slipping and sliding. Well, oh, look at Rusty. He's sideways coming off the turn. And here comes Burton trying to get by.
Bill Weber.
Rusty Wallace for jumping the restart. I believe that's the call. They want Rusty on pit road. We can't hear NASCAR, but the crew very upset. A NASCAR official at the head of Rusty's pit stall. Black flag, watch for it this time again as they come around. Rusty's the race leader, and now he is on pit road. Wow. Unbelievable.
Start that race way back in turn four.
Well, he has led more than any other driver, 224 laps, but now Jeff Burton has command of the race, and Bobby Hamilton is nipping on his heels.
Bobby Hamilton just two tires on that STP Pontiac, and it just might be enough as he takes a look.
Tries to get to the inside. Jeff Burton leaves a lane for him. Hamilton tries to get inside, but can't do it.
Less than 20 laps to go.
And of course, Bobby Hamilton has only one career win. That was in Phoenix last October.
Finished second here in the spring in this very racetrack.
Jeff Burton has won two races this year in Texas and the first race at New Hampshire. Now Hamilton looks to the outside. Now he'll go to the inside. He's got a good run. Let's see what happens down the backstretch. Hamilton is trying to get the lead. They go side by side into three and four. Who's going to come out with the advantage? It's still too close to call.
Dale Earnhardt, I'm sure, back in third place and just watching this, said, okay, guys, please, we'll race for about five laps and I'll be there. There we see Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon.
They are still side by side all the way around the track. Now Burton inches ahead a little as they go into the corner. Ooh, boy, some possible contact there. Hamilton again dives to the inside.
Again, Burton gets a good bite off the corner, but not enough to clear Bobby Hamilton. And here comes Hamilton once again. This is for the lead. 16 laps to go.
Make that 15 to go now as they head into one once again. Oh, they couldn't be closer going into the corner.
And Earnhardt gradually catching up to him. He loves it. As you said, Ben, he said, just do it another lap or two, and I'll be right there. He is right there.
Now it becomes a three-car race.
There's Kim Burt as she watches Jeff trying to hold off Bobby Hamilton. And then Dale Earnhardt, Jeff Gordon.
And Kim is just unbelievably excited, and well, she should be. 13 laps to go. Ward Burton was the pole sitter of this race and is not a factor, but his brother Jeff is.
Hello.
Wow. Ford against Pontiac, Chevy running third and fourth.
Moves up close again.
And Jeff Burton with four fresh tires, you think somewhere along the line it would start helping him a little bit, but so far Hamilton doing a great job hanging on.
Dale Earnhardt, he's only a couple of car lengths behind Hamilton, and Bobby gets a little loose coming out of the corner, and the laps tick down. Now just a little over 10 to go.
Well, Earnhardt is driving that Chevrolet deep into the turns. Of course, he's got to do it. Now's the time. All of them. Have to let everything hang out. Burton's car goes a little bit high there in turn four.
Burton, Hamilton, Earnhardt, Jeff Gordon is running fourth, and Bill Elliott fifth. And again, Hamilton closes right up on the back of Jeff Burton's car.
But Burton getting that good grip off the corner with those four fresh tires.
Meanwhile, Rusty Wallace is lost way back in the pack. He's running in 15th place, the last car on the pack.
As he watches Dale Earnhardt try to chase down the two drivers in front of him. There's Bobby Hamilton's pit.
Pretty calm there.
If you see on the board, 492 laps.
Burton now stretches it out a couple of car lengths.
Fresh tires starting to make a difference.
More than a half second advantage now for Jeff Burton.
Whoever made that call on the 43 car, the STP Pontiac, I think they made a great call.
Here's Earnhardt now working on Hamilton.
He comes down and diamonds off the racetrack, trying to get to the inside of Bobby. This is the battle for second. Oh, and Earnhardt makes a good run into the corner and comes out with second spot. Now, can he catch Jeff Burton and end his long winless streak at 53? Well, he doesn't have much time to go, just a little more than four laps remaining.
And while that pass was being made, while he moved into second, that allowed Burton to pull away by a couple of more car lengths.
Right now, 1 second back to second place. And that time, a second and a quarter. So we saw just a quarter of a second by Pat, that pass that he made on Hamilton. That's how much it cost him. And Bill Elliott has closed up on the back bumper of Jeff Gordon.
It's a good battle among the top five cars. There is Bill Elliott right on the back of Jeff Gordon. As the scoring pylon shows you, Mark Martin, second in points, is 10th at the moment.
He's about to be 11th because Ernie Irvin is right on the inside of him going down into turn one, Bob. Trying to take that position away.
And he does while you watch this battle for fourth spot. Next time around, the white flag will come out.
1 second. 1 second from the leader back to Earnhardt. Jeff Burton back to Earnhardt. Just 1 second.
In fifth position. The white flag is out for Jeff Burton. One more lap to go. Can Dale Earnhardt catch him here in this final lap and pull off a victory?
He gained 0.2 of a second that lap, but you can see the distance. It's too much to make up unless something should happen to that 99 car.
Yeah, he's going to have to miss that bad.
Here is Jeff Burton off of corner number four and taking the checkered flag, winning the Haynes 500. His first short track win in his 117th career start. His third win of 1997, along with Texas and Bill Weber.
And this is Frank Stoddard, along with Tony Liberati, co-car chiefs for Jeff Burton's XI Ford. Congratulations, a big win on a short track.
I tell you what, a great job, all the guys, you know. We did a great job in the pits today, and Buddy Bear, great calls in the pits. And this team, you know, we struggled the last couple weeks with Jeff being sick. And Todd Bodon, I want to thank him. He's here at home today. But he did a great job for us filling in. And we got our man back in the seat, you know. And it was tough for us to do what Todd wanted, you know, with the car we used to Jeff. And Todd did an excellent job in that situation, and we thank him. But today we thank Jeff Burton for wheeling home at Martinsville.
Go to Victory Lane. Congratulations, Frank.
Thanks a lot.
Frank Stoddard and his crew, along with Jeff Burton, headed to Victory Lane here at Martinsville.
So the young man from South Boston, Virginia, becomes the 32nd different driver to win at Martinsville in the Commonwealth of Virginia. We'll be right back to talk with him. Jeff Burton has won the Haynes 500 at Martinsville Speedway. And here's the McDonald's drive-through winner circle interview with Dr. Jerry Punch.
We just got a Gatorade shower, but this guy can shower us because what a job he did. And Jeff Burton, the kid from the Commonwealth of Virginia, gets a victory on a short track in the home state. This has to mean a lot.
Well, that's a tough call for Rusty. I know, you know, they warned him, and that's what we always do. We always start early. They warned him, and I guess he didn't, you know, that's just habit, but that's a tough call for him. We raced real good. Glad he, you know, hated he had that problem because we were racing good and clean. And I want to thank Bobby for racing me clean. And this is a great crew, man. I've been dizzy for 3 weeks, and they put up with me, and finally got my stuff together and come back and win. So this is a real big one.
Tony Liberati, Buddy Parrott, and the guy said, when we get our driver back to 100%, we're going back to victory lane. You're not even 100%, and you're back here today. What an effort those last. I mean, Bobby Hamilton gave you all you could hang on for those last few laps.
Track was real slippery, had a lot of speedy dry on it, and he could get more forward bite than I could. I knew that I was better longer, but I thought he might get by me. But, you know, I just want to say thanks to all these guys and say hi to Art and Cindy Hawkins. Without those guys helping us, we wouldn't be here today. Bobby, come here, Jack. Come here. How about that? We got a short track win.
Hey, by the way, guys, with this victory, Ford wins the Manufacturers Championship for 1997.
Great deal. Fantastic. We got such an advantage over Chevrolet. You know, they gave them some more spoiler, but we'll be all right.
All right, you guys, they look pretty calm, but let's get Kim in here. She's still crying. She hugs her husband, Jeff, in victory lane. Let's check up with Bill Weber.
And it is an amazingly calm Rusty Wallace sitting here on the back of his rig. First of all, Rusty, tell us about the restart you were black flagged for.
Just a normal restart. That's all there is to it. There's oil dry everywhere in the racetrack. They didn't get it cleaned up. We pleaded with him on the radio to blow the track off, and he wouldn't do it. So on the restart, I just did what I normally been doing. I cleaned the tires off real good down the front straight, back straight away. I'm the leader of the race. I start the race, and they didn't like it, and they black flagged me. That's all there was to it.
There was some talk maybe that they had warned you on the restarts. Is that?
They can warn me all they want, but they got to tell you where they want you to start when you're leading the race. You know, and I started the race and just like I've been doing all day long. And that's just a bunch of...
Was there a point in the driver's meeting where they point out where these races restart, Rusty?
No, they're going to have to evidently specify pretty hard now.
And Dale Earnhardt here with a word for Rusty. You want to tell us what he said?
I said, it sucks. I got screwed, and that was it.
So, it's been a frustrating season, Rusty. Your car obviously was great on that last set of tires. It got a little better.
Yeah, I had a good car, good pit stops, really good motor. Everything was good today. I want to thank my entire team and all the sponsors. It was good. It was just this one here will go down to record book. It was just a technicality. It really was. And I'll talk to him, but it doesn't do any good. That's about it.
He's able to smile, but this team and their driver, very, very disappointed, guys.
Well, I did not go to the driver's meeting for the Winston Cup yesterday, but I was in the Craftsman Truck Series driver's meeting, and they said right here, the gate in the wall is this restart point. And as the pace car comes off the corner, and we'll watch the pace car. Right there is where you should accelerate. And it looked like Rusty accelerated back in the corner a little bit. And evidently NASCAR, the officials, said that was too early and black flagging for that.
There is the reaction from the Rusty Wallace team as the word came down to them that Rusty would be black flagged from the lead. And the win now goes to Jeff Burton. We'll be back to wrap things up here at Martinsville in a moment. ESPN Speed World here at Martinsville, Virginia. The Haynes 500 won this afternoon by Jeff Burton. Being brought to you by Valvoline Durabrin, the number one selling semi-synthetic motor oil. By the legendary Firebird Trans Am from Pontiac. And by the Exide NASCAR Select. So reliable, it's the official battery of NASCAR. Jeff Burton wins. Dale Earnhardt finishes second. Jerry?
I can't tell you how good it is to see this seven-time Winston Cup champion smiling after a race. And Dale, what a great effort.
Well, it was. The guys did an awful good job. I got in that oil and slipped and let Bobby get by me. But, you know, then they black-flagged Rusty, and I might have could have raced the 99. Who knows? But what if, you know, what if they hadn't black-flagged Rusty? All I know is we had a great race, and Larry and the guys worked awful hard. Spinney's Union ran all day just like clockwork, and we're heading to Dale Earnhardt Chevrolet to do some autographs.
All right, well, go up there and have a great open house, and champ, you're getting closer.
Well, we are, and, you know, it's these guys just keep working. They ain't let down or give up. You know, they just keep turning it around, and you know, these second-place finishes is pumping them up for the end of the run here at the end of the year, so let's get going and see what we can do.
All right, a very fresh Dale Earnhardt after 500 grueling laps here at Martinsville, his fourth second-place finish of the year. Meanwhile, let's check in with the guy he passed for second spot, who's standing by with Bill Weber.
Well, a great car, a great drive, and some great calls in the pits, and Bobby Hamilton had a great day.
Did, man. We was disappointed because we qualified so bad, and we was actually one of the quickest cars here, and we put that set of tires on and just adjusted ourselves out of the ballpark. Had to pit on the back straightaway, and that hurt us a little bit, but we
one time it hurt you a lot.
Yeah, but one time we put on two tires and went up there and led the race. And he said, we're going to save this for the end of the race. We just kept putting four on with everybody, and everybody kept putting on two. And we stayed away from behind. So we had 180 laps on them left sides right there at the end. And that was one reason I was slipping and sliding up under the 99 car. And, you know, we hit two or three times and got all crossed up. And we was racing a little bit too hard. And I just got to think about it. I said, here comes a three car. Me and him's fishing the wreck. He don't deserve this. I don't deserve it because me and him's always raced pretty clean. There have been a couple others that I've had a problem with in the past. We might have just raced a little harder, but we needed a good finish. It was beneficial for us. It's beneficial for us not to race the three that hard because the 24 is coming. So we just tried to use our heads and pull off a good finish.
Okay, and he did. Bobby Hamilton third here today at Martinsville.
Let's take a look at the unofficial results, and the yellow arrows indicate the drivers who led at least one lap, and the double arrows down there for Rusty Wallace, who finished 15th, indicates that he led the most laps here this afternoon. Here's 16 through 30.
Yeah, there were 15 cars in the lead lap. Then you see there was about seven cars that were one lap down.
And finally, the remainder of the field, Michael Waltrip did lead one lap, finishing in 32nd position. Now the points. The interval is 135. It was 130 until Mark got past there on the last lap. It's 135 now. One position change as Dale Earnhardt moved up into fifth position and Terry Labonte down into sixth spot. Well, next Sunday, Benny and I will be out in Sonoma at Sears Point Raceway for Winston West Racing at 4 o'clock Eastern Time and the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series at 6 o'clock Eastern Time. All that from Sears Point International Raceway. It's been quite a race here today, won by Jeff Burton from South Boston, Virginia. Coming up next here on ESPN Football, the All-American Running Backs. Our next telecast of a NASCAR Winston Cup race will be the season finale in the middle of November from Atlanta Motor Speedway. Thanks for joining us. Congratulations to Jeff Burton. For Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, Bill Weber, and Dr. Jerry Punch, I'm Bob Jenkins. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.